small total.
All the best today.
Thank you.
Good. So there it is from the middle here. Kumar Sangakkara from the Tallawahs has won the toss and elected to bat first.
Well, it seems to be whoever wins the toss in the second game wants to bat. Lendl Simmons, he performed really well yesterday, 53 off 46. He'll certainly want to do that again. Kumar Sangakkara didn't trouble the scorers, but you would expect his experience to be able to come back into the fold. Shakib Hasan, wonderful all-rounder. He's got his ability with the ball, but we're going to see that with the bat. And then from my point of with the ball is Imad Wasim. I think he certainly are going to be a key bowler for the Jamaican Tallawahs.
And just he'll be a key man when it comes to it. Shoaib Malik again, I think, will be a key factor. I want Kieron Pollard to try to make a significant impact with today.
Sorry, this.
Would have learnt from firstly playing the game yesterday but also watching the game as well this morning will mean that they'll know what they need to do. And we heard Kumar Sangakkara talk about the fact it's about accumulating runs. We saw Chris Gayle do that earlier on today.
Let's hear some more from Kumar Sangakkara.
Kumar Sangakkara walking out to bat.
Describe Kumar Sangakkara walking out to bat. I think that's going to be the easiest thing for a commentator, because there is no need for excitement. I just have to say in a very monotonous voice, you know, has been cricketer, still plodding along, going out to bat. So I think that's an apt description of who I am at the moment.
Gone! And Sangakkara is on the walk back.
I'm looking forward to it. I'm excited as usual. You know, when you've played a few years, people ask, you know, do you have the same walk away from the whole game? I think my walk away from Sri Lanka was done at the right time. And it's great that we have all these peripheral, great franchise tournaments to still indulge in and ensure that, you know, you get your cricket fix away from international cricket. The way we play our cricket, the rhythm of cricket is very similar in both nations, and for the West Indies and for Sri Lanka, we take a lot of pride in the way that we play, in the fact that, you know, our countrymen love this sport with a deep passion, but also, you know, like I said before, the island vibes that come with the music. You know, in Sri Lanka you find the trumpets, the drums. You know, win or lose, they enjoy a good contest. And I think that's hopefully what we'll see in every game that's played here in the CPL. We've got a different makeup, so we've got to kind of strategize a bit as to how we're going to fill those voids. I don't think the personalities can ever be matched, but we might have to chip in to you know, to make the runs and the all-round performance of Andre. But just the presence of Chris Gayle and the presence of Russell both. It has hurt Jamaica for sure. We miss them, but at the same time, we wish them well. And as a team, we're just going to regroup and play as well as we can and hopefully keep continuing the winning form that Jamaica has been in.
Former Sri Lankan captain Kumar Sangakkara, now captain of the Tallawahs. And I have to say that
Sony live to entertain. Live to entertain.
Guarded, I found him reserved, but since he's
Sony live to entertain. Sony live to entertain. Sony live to entertain.
A stereotype community where a lot of people unfortunately don't think a lot of good comes out of there. This young man is the first cricketer I know to come out of there. Fatima College took him in, the alma mater of Brian Lara, Joey Carew, the late Tony Kozier. Craig Kozier's father was there for a while. I'm thankful that the
Sony live to entertain.
Hosein picked up 2 for 24, but he also got 22 not out off 10 deliveries, which I think at the back end for the Tridents allowed them with Wayne Parnell to be able to post something over that 140 odd. So the real question will be, can the top order from both teams be able to
We had a special moment today, folks. If you've just joined us, we had a special moment today. We had a catch which I will still refer to as the best I have seen in cricket. I haven't seen every catch. It is the best that I have seen. Fabian Allen of Jamaica. I know the guys are tweeting me. I have never seen a better one.
No, and that's the thing. We're not across every game, but the fact to see it here live, the way that he moved towards the ball, the height that he got to, and then also looked after the ball when he landed. Hasan Ali can't believe it. He just snagged a wicket.
Now listen to my words, it's the best I have seen. I'm not saying it's the best ever.
Oh, I understand. We just got to make sure the viewers understand.
Okay. No, I'm gonna get some stick later on.
As you should.
Let's find out what social media is saying. I've watched a lot of cricket and that's the most insane catch I've ever seen. Thank you, David. You're a great man. David Coates at @combox_Coatesy.
Well, he's your favorite. Hasan, Superman. What Superman? Look at this catch by Allen. That's impressive.
Russell Shah, that's the best catch ever. I've won the poll.
Have you got the producer on your side? That was all the tweets supporting you.
It's amazing what friendship can do. Anyway, it's time for a short break. And then when we come back, we will have more action from game number 5.
It's not over until it's over. In the third and last match of the Test Series, the mighty Team India look to finish off in style. Can the hosts rise to the challenge and prove their mettle? In the Seagram's Royal Stag Mega Cricket Cup Test Series, powered by Servo Lubricants, Sri Lanka versus India. Third test, Saturday, August 12th, 9:15 a.m., live on Sony 6 and Sony 10.3.
far is your goal? Depends on how well you can tackle, dribble, and pass. That's football, or as they call it, life.
Go beyond with Sony 10.2 and Sony 10.2 HD, home of the world's best footballing action. Sony Pictures Sports Network. Go beyond.
Europe's elite clubs bring you flamboyant football as they chase club football's greatest prize, the UEFA Champions.
So get up, and unite for your team. Go, go. Give the best we've got. Guess how we got.
Galaxy of stars on show. And beyond the boundary, the atmosphere has been cooking for some time. The Carrot Girls and the entertainers have been in full swing. What a beautiful crowd here at this ground today. A lot of Amazon Warriors fans still at the ground. And the real party atmosphere, the biggest party in sport. And you know when the entertainer is taking a selfie of himself, how it goes down. The Tallawahs here with Kumar Sangakkara, and they won the toss and batted, and I think Sangakkara is due some runs today after his failure yesterday. Shakib Hasan is also a key performer with all his experience, the Bangladeshi international, and my co-commentator had spoken about Imad Wasim earlier as well with his skilled new ball bowling. And then you can probably go down the line to Mohammed Sami, another overseas player out of Pakistan. Quite a few internationals from Pakistan in this year's CPL.
Talk about talent and the stars. The Barbados Tridents certainly have quite a number of players that are match winners. Dwayne Smith, he certainly needs to fire with the bat. Just over 1,000 run strike rate of 116. Williamson, he played his first game in the CPL yesterday. He would have enjoyed that experience. He's going to learn and grow from that. Pollard, well, we know what he can do with the bat. He's just got that ability to take the game away from anyone at any stage. Wayne Parnell, I was impressed with how he bowled, despite the first over being a little bit erratic. So expect some firepower from the Tridents. Match number five here, Jamaica Tallawahs. Given the fact that the Jamaicans out here will be celebrating Independence Day. There's all sorts of creatures that have crept into Lauderhill for this doubleheader today, Super Sunday as some would call it. Well, we saw such an entertaining game this morning, the fact that it came down to the wire and everyone has hung around for another fixture, making sure that they're just tweeting, I think probably Ian Bishop, about catch. Music is still pumping and the dinosaur is enjoying that as well. Only in the CPL, it's my first experience with this tournament and you just keep smiling. There's so many things to smile and laugh about. Everyone having a fun time, bit of dancing. Still haven't seen your move, Bish.
I'm just happy with Fabian Allen's move and the tweets that I'm getting here, and people are forgetting my context. It's the best catch that I've ever seen. People are tweeting stuff and saying this one, that one. I'm thankful for the interactions, but I did not see every catch. I'm not saying it's the best catch ever. It's the best I have ever seen. Have a look at this. Will this be better than this year's CPL?
I don't think so. I'm saying that earlier, and we're up to match five now. But his ability to chase down that ball, get so aerial. We talk about Superman, so many people are tweeting. It was Superman-esque, and it certainly was. And I love the way that he protected the ball. He never brought the hand in. The hand just stayed out to allow him to go with the ball. Oh, look at those moves. Well, he's a candidate for the El Dorado happiest fan alive. Two fans from each CPL region get the chance to fly to the CPL finals in Trinidad, Caribbean Airlines, and they get that VIP experience. I think he'd hot it up in the VIP tent, moves like that.
Fabian Allen will be immortalized in history, for good or bad, because there's competition now as to which one was the best. Anyway, we saw an excellent innings from Chris Gayle here, and Fabian Allen on Independence Day for Jamaica has given them something in addition to Chris Gayle's knock today. Couple of gentlemen I just saw there. That gentleman I just saw was talking to me during one of my interviews downstairs, and he is a member of what he says is one of the oldest clubs in the USA, cricketing clubs. Anyway, on to match number five. Wow. Well,
umpires are pumped.
Johan Kloter from South Africa. On the right of your screen, from Pretoria, now can the Tridents improve on what we saw yesterday?
Well, we've seen from all teams that the fielding certainly wasn't sharp. You know, yesterday, eight catches went down. No team was immune from that. We've seen a better fielding display in the first game. I think the Tridents need to lift not only in their catching ability, but their ground fielding. Those half chances need to be taken. No fumbles. This outfield here in Lauderhill is excellent. So you certainly can't blame the outfield for any bobbles. The Tallawahs have got the opportunity. They won the toss, electing to bat. We saw the Tridents do the same thing yesterday in the second match. And on this wicket, the fourth game being played on it, you would expect that's going to get harder and harder for the batters to really score runs.
Welcome back, welcome back to the plan. Welcome to Central Park Regional Park. We're about to see Jamaica Tallawahs up against the Barbados Tridents.
Lendl Simmons. Coming back and playing in a different franchise. He started off well. Brought up a half century yesterday, but a little bit of lackadays running really cost his wicket. Wayne Parnell from South Africa, just 28 years of age. Economy rate 7.88. Certainly want to improve on that. Simmons, age 32, wealth of experience, had such a good IPL for Mumbai Indians. And Kumar Sangakkara, well, we all know about him. Didn't matter what format he played, he still plays. Still a match winner. Captaining the side, given the fact that Chris Gale still a match winner. Captaining the side, given the fact that Chris Gayle has left. So we're all ready for the action here for match number 5.
Let's play.
You almost want the umpires to say play ball, given that we are in the US.
Wayne Parnell yesterday was expensive in his first over. I think he went for 20 in his first over yesterday. But he starts much better today, a much better line. I'm glad Pollard has got himself in a slip on this surface against the new ball.
Yeah, the fact that he bowled almost a licorice all sorts in the first over, a number of wides. It was just a never-ending over. And then he kept readjusting his line and length from his previous deliveries and made it very hard for Kieron Pollard to set a field to him. First runs off the bat, clipped away nicely.
And we talked in the earlier game about Gajanan Singh, who got an opportunity after playing West Indies under 19 cricket in 2006. Now, if that tournament, where that youth tournament, I wonder if Wayne Parnell would have played in that youth World Cup with Gajanan Singh. I'm almost sure he would have. Gajanan Singh, obviously.
Slightly towards you.
I gave him a few runs too many. He went for 15 in that first over yesterday. Wayne Parnell, not 20. Still, it was indifferent. Wayne Parnell did play that same World Cup with Gajanan.
Nice shake. Upish as well, and nearly Kane Williamson had the opportunity to potentially pick up a wicket, but just found the gap.
And if you remember yesterday with Sangakkara, Ravi Rampaul got him in a similar area, driving to point. This time it goes just to the left of Williamson. Yeah, he's been watching Fabian Allen.
Well, this is what Kumar Sangakkara has to be careful of. And you have a look at this, and you can see the dismissal from the first game. He opens up the blade, and he hits it a lot later and squarer than what he wants. And again, the same thing, the blade is open. So he needs to make sure he's going full face and be able to punch the ball into the cover region. That's better. Full of face on that and along the ground all the way.
Well, I talked about Parnell going for 15 off his first over yesterday. He started better with the first two balls, but now he's gone for 9 with one ball to go. So he wants to keep his line nice and tight to Kumar Sangakkara. Don't give him that room, but don't get too straight.
Left this time. So 9 runs off the first over.
Lovely outfit possessed by the Tallawahs. Almost lost the microphone in Sangakkara's trousers at the toss.
Because of the same color.
That's the only reason.
Yes. Yeah, nice bright yellow. Something that I'm certainly used to. The Australian team, their yellow kit.
It's called gold. It's referred to gold as gold from Jamaica's point of view. Green and gold. Independence Day in Jamaica, so the Tallawahs, the franchise based in that country. It's not a national team. Remember that for those of you new to the game. It's not a national team, but it's a franchise based in that country, which still evokes emotions of patriotism and symbolism. Ravi Rampaul will share the new ball with Parnell. And the Tallawahs, well, I suppose the meaning of it is you're Tallawah, little but strong.
Call Simmons. Is 2.
Little but fearless, Lisa. Little but fearless.
I like it. I like anything small.
And fearless.
And fearless.
2 legs, Lisa.
But it is interesting because a lot of the T20 franchises tend to kind of associate with a city. Whereas here in the CPL, it's, I guess everyone thinks of the West Indies as a country, which it isn't. It's made up of all individual countries. Jamaica, Barbados, St. Kitts, Nevis, Trinidad and Tobago. So it's almost seen globally as still little islands with a city-based support following. Driven again. Beautiful cover drive. Something that we're so used to seeing from Kumar Sangakkara.
I've often said that if there was a silhouette of a batsman like Sangakkara, this would be the shot that would be emblazoned in the silhouette. Now, Rampaul got him caught at point yesterday for naught. Now he's going to get his own back. Teammates at Surrey Cricket Club over the last couple of seasons.
It is just his signature shot. You can see the open blade, but still he comes around nicely, drops the back leg, high front elbow. Take all the photos right now. Glorious shot. He tries to go again.
For me, Lisa, this is interesting. Why has Rampaul started round the wicket to Sangakkara? Because yesterday when he got Sangakkara out, he was bowling over the wicket and he pushed the ball across him and it worked. So has he decided today he doesn't want to give him this room, which worked for him yesterday, and he's coming round the wicket to try to cut out that width outside the off stump?
Well, I agree with you. I think they've missed a trick. The fact that even in the previous over, Sangakkara had that open face and he did hit the ball aerial. So it is a point of weakness at the moment. And despite how well Sangakkara has been, all players have weaknesses early on in their innings. And that certainly is one for Sangakkara. So by coming around the wicket, they've taken away that angle.
Oh, brilliant! Brilliant! A Republic Bank classic. Fabian Allen, eat your heart out. It's Kane Williamson now. What a catch.
Well, the show just keeps continuing here at the CPL. And Sangakkara goes again, caught Williamson by Ravi Rampaul. And the Tallawahs lose their first wicket, 14 for 1.
What a catch. And I was just talking about why has Rampaul come around the wicket. Well, this is why. Over the wicket. Oh, Kane. Give him a cape. Not nearly as good as Fabian, but close. Brilliant.
And he likes it. You can tell. Whenever a player lands there and just wants everyone to come to him, they know, yes, I've nailed that catch. So Kane Williamson, again, it's the show, the fact that he's able to catch out Kumar Sangakkara twice now.
Ravi?
The new batter.
Right.
Is Andre McCarthy.
Yeah.
Had a good innings yesterday. Well, the reason why McCarthy's here is because of that man, Kane Williamson. Again, that open blade. We spoke about that potentially being a weakness for Sangakkara. The fact that he's hit a number of balls aerial backward of point. It's all about getting the right fielder at the right time, at the right angle. And that's exactly what Kane Williamson did.
I'll come back to this.
Calls for two, and I'll get it quite comfortably.
Can I apologize to Rampaul? Ravi, I'm sorry. I asked why you were coming round the wicket when you got him bowling over the wicket yesterday. I'm sorry, Ravi, because it still worked from round the wicket. Amazing. I'm absolutely sure he came round the wicket to stop him from playing that shot, extending the arms. That's serious bragging rights if they get back to Surrey.
You and I seem to be apologising a lot, don't we, at the moment? I had to apologise to Chris Gale for bowling Brathwaite the last over. But in real time, great catch, good movement. And he likes it.
I don't want you to feel lonely. That's the only reason
thank
I apologise.
You. No.
Didn't want you to be a group of one.
You're such a team player, Bish. I enjoy working with you.
You're in a group of one once again.
It's all right. I'll stick my neck out for you.
Great from Kane Williamson. Oh.
Well, there was a noise. I think that it brushed his leg as it came through. That did sound very woody. So, I guess we'll never know, really. Fine leg was up, so it was a poor delivery anyway.
Wahab!
So a good over so far, just the two runs coming from it, a lot better than his first over. That went for nine. Slowly getting his line and length right. So great over, just the three runs coming from it. 17 for one.
One of the real battles today is to be able to get 150 or more. I think, Lisa, through two games yesterday, through today's game, we talked about 150 being an aim for the team batting first. It hasn't been achieved yet.
Sangakkara, again, the first wicket to fall for Jamaica Tallawahs. Thanks very much to Kane Williamson, Superman effort. Lendl Simmons has struggled a little bit. They seem to be bowling a little bit more back of a length to him, not giving him anything where he can come on the front foot to drive.
Well, and that's a critical thing about knowledge base, Lisa, and you would have experienced this. Both these players come from Trinidad and Tobago, and you should see them when they're at practice. The amount of stick they give to each other. You can't hit me there. You can't hit me here. Over the years.
Well, poor delivery because he followed him. But it was that poor that all he had to do was get something on it, and he did.
And it's instinctive to follow a batsman when he backs away. But one of the things you can also do if you're skilled enough is when you see him tail away to leg, you can bowl it wide up off stump where he's challenged to reach it. Because you've got a short, fine leg, it's a danger to follow. But smart from Lendl Simmons as well.
He fakes to do it again. Just a single this time.
Lisa, I just want to repeat what I feel about this kid, Akeal Hosein, and I talked about it in the build-up, about him coming from Lavantil in East Trinidad. He's the first cricketer I've known, that's I'll just more. Repeat that, who's come out of that area. Because it's an area, it's not an affluent area. It's been stereotyped as an area where not a lot of good things come out of it. He was taken in by Fatima College, by the teachers there, because of the potential that he has had with cricket and everything.
Call is for two. And they'll get it.
And I just think it was a story worth repeating because I know Akeal very well. I know his love for the game. And I think he's a great, great story generally in cricket, Trinidad and Tobago's cricket and West Indies cricket. He's got a first-class 100 a couple of years ago. He has pretensions as a batsman as well as a left-arm spinner. He loves the game. I'm thankful for Fatima College, the alma mater of Brian Lara, Darren Bravo.
Short again.
And, of course, the members of the Queen's Park Cricket Club who have taken him into their fold as well. So I was so pleased to see him get man of the match yesterday. He's had a rough last 12 months. 20-odd runs yesterday, critical to the end of the innings, and two wickets at a critical time. Now, that could all change today. May get nothing either side, but he's a wonderful story of CPL and West Indies cricket.
Shouts of catch it. Flicked away nicely by Simmons. Nine runs coming off it, 26 for one. One thing that you were mentioning in the car the other day was the fact that a lot of West Indian stars are very grateful and thankful for the people that helped them initially when they may not have had a lot of support, a lot of financial backing. They relied on a few helpful people and they've never forgotten them.
Yeah, people like Kieron, Pollard, who is also a mentor to Akeal at Queen's Park. I mean, Pollard has been tremendous. Dwayne Bravo has been tremendous in giving back to the young cricketers, not only at their club, but at their country level. And I think they get a bad rap. You look at what's going on in world cricket now. A lot of these players have been called mercenaries when they moved into the T20 global traveling field. But look at what's happening with other countries now, the McCollums, the Warners. They have followed the path.
Wahab Riaz in midfield. So again, sloppy fielding, crossing the Tridents. And it's the captain, Kieron Pollard. Bags not being a player to talk to him about his misfield.
He's not as mobile as he used to be. He's had injuries to both knees over the years, and significant injuries, and almost to the point where he walks or runs with a limp. It's not due to pain, but he's had to compensate so much. He's lost a lot of weight, which he's had to do because of those knee injuries.
Well, then, does he position himself somewhere different? Not mid-wicket.
He still thinks he is the best fielder in the history of the game. He's taken some great catches.
He has.
He's going to be jealous of Fabian Allen and Kane Williamson here today. Let me tell you that.
Well, you normally see him out on the boundary, don't you? Certainly in the IPL, he mans that
later
boundary.
Later on, he will go there. As captain, later on when the death overs are bowling, he will go to the boundary.
And that's something for all players. You sometimes, as a captain, you don't necessarily have to be inside the inner circle. It does help to be able to talk to the bowler about the tactics. But another example, as they look for two and they won't get it, is David Warner for Sunrisers Hyderabad. Always see him manning that deep long on or deep long off.
And that's interesting. You know, it's how the game has changed. I remember in a contest, I think it was 50-over cricket, a regional 50-over tournament, Dwayne Bravo does the same thing. The captains go to the boundary because they're the best fielders. They go to the hotspot areas. I'll come back to it. And I specifically remember commentators questioning, why is Bravo on the boundary? He's captain. Why is Sammy on the boundary? He's captain. Why is Pollard on the boundary? He's captain. And now it's par for the course. Even though they're captain, they don't need to be in the bowler's ear all the time. They are the best fielders. They go to the high traffic areas. It's par for the course now.
But also, the fact is that the bowlers have a great understanding of where they want to bowl and what field they want. So a lot more responsibility on the bowlers. Well, helped along nicely. Came inside the line of it and got it just past fine leg.
Got to decide where you're bowling to Simmons. Simmons moves around the crease and he can be very difficult to bowl to when he decides that he wants to be the aggressor. If you're going to bowl him off stump and just wide, stay there. Don't open up both sides of the pitch.
Also, just to finish that conversation we had about captains being on the boundary, also allows them to look at the game from a different perspective. And you also find a lot of messages are easily being able to pass on to the captain if they're out on the boundary instead of relying on someone to run on.
3rd man has come up.
Seven runs from that, 33 for one.
Thank you.
Lendl Simmons is leading here for the Jamaica Tallawahs, 17 from 17. Sangakkara out to a wonderful catch by Kane Williamson. Backward point and Andre McCarthy. Now here's Ravi Rampaul, slapped away by Simmons. He's going to get four for this. Goodness, that was a heck of a sound from that bat.
Yeah, wonderful shot, using his feet to get to the pitch of it. A little bit more momentum into the shot. Wasn't a half volley, nowhere near a half volley, but manages to wait on it enough to be able to put it away through the covers. It's looking good here, Lendl Simmons.
He's got a few extra gears to his gearbox, I think, Simmons. Sometimes doesn't bother with first and second. He starts in third. And he's doing a well run. Hosein, the fielder. He can get runs at a rate of knots, this fella.
Yeah, no, he's an interesting player to watch because you're absolutely right. He has got many gears, and I think he assesses games very, very well. But he looks at home in this format. He really does look at home because I think he sort of mastered the puzzle of T20 cricket, and it does take time to get it right because at times you're not sure at what tempo to be going. But he seems to be able to adjust it very quickly and assess it and go at the right tempo.
So he's opened with great success for the Mumbai Indians and the Indian Premier League. Here he's put off. Oh, look, he's unhappy with that because he's made Ravi Rampaul bowl a bad ball because he's come down the pitch to him. He's got the full toss. He didn't put it away.
Yeah, well, he's made Ravi Rampaul consider bowling a Yorker, which he got wrong. So he's made him think defensively with his bowling.
Top half of the bat. How much has he got on this? One bounce, four. That'll do.
A terrific shot from McCarthy. He looked good yesterday in his brief visit. He looked pretty fluent. Relatively new to the top of the order for this Tallawahs outfit, but looked very much at home when the ball's halfway down. Look at that. Got onto it very early, lifting it over wide mid-on. Had a good piece of it.
You're right, he did look good yesterday. He looked, you're talking about somebody looking at home and settled. McCarthy looked the part yesterday. Leg side again from Rampaul.
Yeah, one ball left to this power play overs. Six, of course, in the power play overs, and they're on 45 now, so the batting side will be very comfortable with that. 45 is about above average, you would say, well and truly on a surface like this, but it's about par on most other surfaces. A dot ball to finish the over. It's an expensive one too. 12 coming from it. It's 45 for one.
That's the end of the power play, guys.
Yeah, it's a good partnership between this pair. It's made its way to 31 off 24. It's very important for the top order to do most of the heavy lifting. Certainly these two are doing their job.
Tallawahs, six overs and the power play over, bringing a decent reward, 45 for one. Simmons and McCarthy in harness here. Well, that was the flowing blade of Kumar Sangakkara. He's a strong man through there. That's a glorious cover drive. Went for one more and was brilliantly held by Kane Williamson off Rampaul. And meanwhile, Lendl Simmons has enjoyed himself, slaps away another 4-3, and that was a big blow as well by McCarthy.
Same score from yesterday, guys. Same score from
going to be a change of bowling now. Akeal Hosein will bowl his spin. Meanwhile, Rampaul's gone for 26 in three. Man of the match yesterday, Akeal Hosein.
Yeah, 2 for 24 yesterday. Bowled well. He did bowl well, and he was very effective with the bat in hand as well. And an important 22 at the back end of the innings, just off 10 deliveries. So it was a really good all-round performance from him.
Well, these are the two wickets he got yesterday. Shakib, Al Hasan, a big scalp. And then Jonathan Fu caught behind.
It's lovely shape on that second delivery. So the ball dip and turn nicely.
Just like that.
On cue.
But it's good, isn't it? He's not one of these round arms. Look how high that arm is, the bowling arm. Didn't spin an awful lot, it just held its line.
Yeah, he looks good. He looks like he's got a good technique, good release. Look at this delivery. See the overspin on the ball there? With the overspin, what you get is that dip. When you see the seam quite upright like that, the ball does dip if the spinner is getting some revs on it. So not only will he get dip, he'll get bounce because of the overspin on the ball. So good signs. It's certainly a good release position for Hosein there.
Bit of a slog to finish. One off the last ball. Three from the over. 48 for one. Kieron Pollard with a few bowling options, quite a few in fact, including himself. I'm not sure how much bowling. I just heard Ian Bishop talking about the injuries that Pollard has had in recent times. I've seen Pollard bowl, we all have in the IPL. For a big man, the ball comes out very gently. I don't think he ever tries to bowl quick. The hero hunk. During this hero Caribbean Premier League, I am going to ride, maybe not that bike, but one of them.
Definitely.
And Moots, if you're in St. Lucia, if you want to ride around the island, I'll take you on it.
Well, I'd rather be riding it myself. I'm going to be on the back when you're in charge, particularly with a vehicle with that stature.
So here we go. Change of bowling. One of the many options for Kieron Pollard in his turn to Shoaib Malik.
What's interesting here, Pollard is obviously recognising, trying to take pace off the ball, see if he can change the momentum of this innings. Certainly Shoaib Malik has got a lot of experience. He'll be obviously turning it into the right-handers.
Well, it's a good start, this, for the Tallawahs, who won the toss, batted first, going along at just a fraction under seven.
It's interesting just watching the Tallawahs so far. I know we're only in the eighth over, but something that Kumar Sangakkara said post-match yesterday after their loss was that he wanted people to play with more freedom. He felt that they just didn't back themselves as a batting group and they didn't really take the game on, particularly in the middle overs, he said. What I'm sensing so far in this innings is there is that sort of freedom, and they're playing an aggressive brand regardless of what may have happened previously, regardless of the fact they've had a loss, but they're just playing with a lot more sort of with a free spirit, without the worry of consequences. That's the greatest fear of any batsman, is what if I miss hit this and I get out. You forget about the what if, just back yourself, play the shots,
which is what Simmons is doing. Little scoop from McCarthy, and he might just get two. Okay. 50 coming up in the eighth over for the Tallawahs.
this pair had a good partnership yesterday, didn't
62,
they?
62. 62 yeah. They put on after Sangakkara went first ball. So really, with the 50 coming up in the eighth over, going along on this, it's the platform here. This commentary box has talked about a score of 150. That 150 hasn't been achieved, but there's a platform here for that to take place. Another single. Six from the over, 754 for one.
Well, we've been lucky with the weather here in Florida, Fort Lauderdale.
Which is very close to where we are here in Lauderhill.
Exactly. Give it the absolute location. Apart from being very warm, it's good cricketing conditions. And also this time of year, weather-wise, you not only get the very warm days, Alan, you also get the odd thunderstorm. And we've been lucky not to have had any interruption with any showers or thunder action.
Yeah, actually, I thought we would have got some thunder showers. They've stayed away. There you go. Hot and humid. That's what we've got. It's like Durban times 10. Singapore. Played cricket in Singapore, Moods?
I played in a sort of exhibition shortened game there many moons ago.
Did you? There but we are. That's one for the family album.
Hot venues around the world. There's, you could reel off many in the subcontinent.
Oh, sweet killie.
Chennai.
Oh, he's given that a wide. Is that a bit harsh? The ball spun. Is this harsh? Yes, I think it is. The ball is spun. Johan Klute, umpire. It's a very nice action, this, isn't it? Yeah, the grand staff. Done a good job.
Keep going, Akeal.
Yeah, there's not too many days in the year that cricket get played at this venue, so it's an adventure for us all, really. It's a wonderful facility, really, isn't it?
Yeah, fantastic. Well, that is a wide. That slipped out of the hand. Almost a different. His bowling arm was in a different position there.
I reckon he was anticipating that Lendl Simmons was going to come down the wicket to him, so he's throwing it out wide. And maybe that one's just slipped out of the hand.
It's just a...
That's good work, buddy. Don't move from there, buddy. That's good.
An aberration you'd not rather not repeat. That's two in a row. McCarthy on strike, 15 from 15. Likes to go down the ground. Malik, the fielder, Shoaib Malik. Nice piece of fielding. Got his body behind the ball. Hit pretty hard by McCarthy. So three wides in this over and two singles. It's a real mixed bag. And still two balls to go to complete the ninth. It's a bottom edge, isn't it?
Yeah, certainly no chance for the keeper, but slowly tossed up wide of off stump. He's really mixing up his pace and line here, isn't he? Hosein. He's got to finish this over now.
That's a good one.
He's got away with just a one to finish the over. Seven coming from it. It's 61 for one.
Simmons, 29 from 28, and Ravi Rampaul has been a little bit on the expensive side, 1 for 26 from his 3. There's the old Kiwi shirts, they've gone back to the sort of beige, haven't they?
That's a 1992 World Cup shirt.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
I'm not sure if he played. Probably not.
Semi-finalists, weren't they? New Zealand?
Booked them in every time.
Come on, boys. This five boys is important tonight.
Martin Crow, the player of the tournament, Martin Crow. R.I.P. Martin Crow.
That's good work, Shaki.
Deepak Patel surprised us all by opening the bowling in that World Cup, and since then it's a given. Now in T20 cricket you quite regularly see spinners open the bowling. It's an important tactic in a lot of cases. Oh, great batch, the opening batter, the left-hander. He's batted very well that tournament as well.
Well, I reckon they look as relaxed as anyone. Guardian group, live easy moment. Shaki. Right there, I think. Just expending a little bit of energy with the fan. There we are.
Shaks! Do the leveries! Do the leveries!
Nice pair of shoes.
Just feel that Lendl Simmons feels a little bogged down here. 30 from 31.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think the last couple of overs, it's just got a little bit shaky, hasn't it? You sort of projected the 150. Maybe that's in question now.
Akeal!
Two is the call.
Bowlers!
Akeal Hosein is the fielder. Nice piece of fielding. Doesn't prevent the second, though. 10 overs gone. And the Tallawahs are 65 for one here in Lauderhill. And we're going to have a Carib drinks break. Thank you.
65 for one. The Tallawahs batting first. And just a reminder of some of the delights that you can partake of if you happen to turn up at this wonderful facility for the Hero CPL. The limes, the season, whatever meats are going to be prepared, tomatoes, wonderful salads, conch salad. You can have a lot of variations. Of course, we saw the rotis, the jerk chicken being prepared. Wahab Riaz to Simmons. Easily done, Kieron Pollard. I wonder if he mistimed his jump or whether he really needed to, but he's held on to it. And you won't find a better athlete, injured knees and all. And that'll sweeten him because he's taken a catch off a good friend of his in Lendl Simmons. 30 to Simmons, 65 for two.
Yeah, quite brilliant. It's like plucking oranges from a tall tree. I'll have that, thank you. Yep, he did get off the ground. Just. But still a very good catch. Very good catch and an important wicket too. Wahab Riaz is only into his second over and he's struck. He's known as a wicket taker. And he's delivered for his captain.
Imad Wasim has come in a little bit early, I think, that he did in yesterday's game. He is a good striker of the cricket ball. Facing his international teammate, Wahab Riaz. Can the Tallawahs get to 150? Can they get to 150 on this surface?
Bringing himself into a wide slip position, so he's on the attack.
Close, dead, gone, surely, yes, Johan Kloten raises a finger. Wahab Riaz gets rid of his sometimes international teammate. 2-2 for Wahab Riaz and the Tridents. That's a good duck there, as far as the Tridents are concerned. 65 for three.
Yeah, spot on from Wahab Riaz. Full, straight, dead. Middle stump is exactly where you want to be for the new batsman. He hasn't got himself in, he hasn't had a sighter. Get it full, get it straight. You miss, I hit, you're out.
And you can see the excitement there from Pollard as well as he approached Wahab Riaz in that last shot. Chance for Rovman Powell, who came in ahead of Imad Wasim yesterday, coming in after him today. No Shakib Al Hasan yet. Back-to-back wickets for Wahab.
Yeah, this is the first one straight after the Carib drinks break. Spooned a catch to the skipper, and then the second full straight. Absolutely plum LBW.
Short leg and hat-trick ball. What do you think about the short leg?
To be honest with you, probably not a smart fielding position if you're going to bowl full and wide of off stump for a hat-trick ball.
Or probably not a smart delivery if you've got a short leg.
I like the idea of it, but I would have thought it might have been a rib tickler.
Yes.
And yeah. The batsman trying to fend it off and possibly a glove ballooning up. I like the idea of it. I probably like more the idea of a slip with a ball going across the right-hander.
Oh, another one! 3-4 for Wahab Riaz. The innings has turned on its head. What an over drama of this left arm quick. Rovman Powell disappears for another duck. 65 for four.
Oh, I don't like batsmen getting ducks, but I do like that little image of the duck with the beanie on, a little inside edge, just no man's land, really, technically. He wasn't there to play it. He wasn't there to leave it. He was doing nothing, really, and just found his back coming down on an angle, which created the inside edge. You know, maybe the short leg was in position as a bit of a decoy, getting the batsman to think that he was going to get one up around the ribs, but instead they were going to operate around about that off stump.
Some of our viewers may not have heard what Tom Moody said in between the batsman departing and the new batsman coming in. Shakib Hasan, who batted pretty early yesterday, did he bat at three, batted at four yesterday. But it's not a position you often see, even in the longest formats in the modern game. But it's not always there, Tom, to get a catch. It just probably gets into the mind of a batsman when a short leg is in there.
Yeah, there's no question. And I think, you know, at times it can sow the seed to the batsman that he's preempting the ball's going to be short and up around the ribs. But instead, the bowler will bowl a good line across that off stump and his feet won't be in position.
Lovely delete. Misdirection, they call it.
You know, so often it is a mental game. Well, not so often. Every single time it's a mental game, this game that we play and love. And that's what the captaincy of Pollard is doing. He's just playing with a batsman's mind, getting him to think and question what the bowler's going to be bowling, instead of the batsman just having a clear mind, making sure he's relaxed at the crease, going through his various cues and getting into a good position to play the ball from the ball release.
No, no. 65 for four.
Well, that's a fair over. You'd have to say it's a three-wicket maiden, which is not often seen in any format of the game, but rarely seen in the T20 game. It's a triple-wicket maiden, and Wahab Riaz has smashed it out of the park there with 3 for 7.
Let's go downstairs to Alan Wilkins, who's got a special guest with him.
We do have a special guest. It's Richard Kaplan, who's mayor of Lauderhill. Richard, thanks very much for having us in your lovely city.
Well, thank you very much for being here. We really do appreciate you coming by.
You've got a wonderful cricket ground here. And we saw last year, we saw the Indians and West Indies having a wonderful game of cricket. How excited are you by having the Hero Caribbean Premier League here?
Well, we really love this because this is what the community wanted. It's a great place for the teams to come to play. There is a following here. So we're really thrilled that they're here every year that they come.
How long have you been mayor of Lauderhill?
Just about 20 years at this point.
20 years. So I reckon now that you've brought cricket here in the last couple of years, you've got at least another 10 in you.
No, I'm retiring at the end of next year. It's my time.
So tell me now, what about, I mean, this ground is purpose-built for cricket. What has been the interest shown by locals in the game of cricket?
Well, we've had very good turnouts for many of the games, particularly the international games. Last year's game you mentioned about the West Indies-Indy game was very good turnout, incredible coverage worldwide on television watched, and it was a great scoring game, that Saturday game. So it was very popular. It went over very well.
How long do you think a process might be of convincing Americans who obviously have baseball in their forefront of their minds to play this game of cricket?
Well, this used to be the national pastime of the United States. Cricket used to be played on the front lawn of the White House, and many universities and people used to play until about World War I. It was a very popular game. So we're having kind of a renewed interest in the United States, trying to get other places around the country to develop cricket fields and stadiums, and we'll see what we get with it.
Now, you've got a cricketing background yourself. Where have you played your cricket?
Well, I played it mostly here, but they had me travel a little bit to play. One game we played down in Peru and Miramar Masters, and we played against the Peruvian and the Chilean national team, and we actually won both games. And then went over to Jamaica, played a little friendly game, but mostly it was here a few years anymore, though.
And I know you're very self-effacing about this, but you are in the United States Cricket Hall of Fame, am I right?
Yes, I am. Years ago they put me in. It was a great honor.
Well, that's a wonderful achievement. What do you hope to see here in the next couple of years? How do you see cricket developing?
Well, first of all, to continue international play here in this facility, and they're looking over the next couple of years to make some more improvements here, more stands, that kind of thing. But to really get U.S. cricket moving along the way, we really do have to get other facilities built in the United States. We have to build up a U.S. team and a U.S. structure so that it will support cricket, and we'll see what comes of it.
Richard, thanks very much indeed. Thanks for your time.
Appreciate it. Thank you for coming.
Kane Williamson was dropped in that last over. Oh, brilliant, almost brilliant anyway, almost great effort.
This was hit very, very firmly from McCarthy. Barnwell out there at deep cover had to make a lot of ground around to his right, and what a valiant effort from him to try to keep that in. He tried to tap it back into the field of play.
That's high in the air, and that's gone. That has disappeared. Sunshine Snacks power shot.
Terrific strike, tossed up, inviting the batsman to have a go, and didn't he fill his boots. Had a right crack at it over mid-wicket. Gone with the one hand. Oh. Catching's hard enough, but just to throw the one hand at it.
There was a drop chance off the bat of Andrew McCarthy in the last over ball by Imran Khan. I think it was Kane Williamson who took that blinder to get rid of Kumar Sangakkara. It's a nice line. I like that line. That's a really good line. Touching down on middle stump from Hosein.
Yeah, it nearly appeared that he did struggle with the background. It sort of hit him a lot harder than he expected, and maybe something in the background was challenging him. Not making any excuses for Kane Williamson, though, because he doesn't need them. 13 gone, it's 84 for 4.
You are.
I may just favour him a little bit, but why wouldn't you when you see what he's done in the game?
I wonder why. A lot of people talk, Tom, and you're intrinsically involved with the players, and a number of them have made the Dream Team Fantasy scoreboard so far today. Lendl, Simmons on top, McCarthy still there, and a chance to go top of this pile. Kane Williamson on the scoreboard for the Dream 11 Fantasy team, even though he put down that catch, but is one to dismiss Sangakkara, has him what, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth place. Simmons on top by virtue of his knock. I wonder what the impact of his knock in the heat yesterday would have had on his longevity today. How simple is it to recover or challenging as Malik comes into the attack for another over?
I think it depends on the athlete. I think it depends on their fitness levels. I think it depends on how professional they are with their recovery routine. Oh, that's poor. Imran Khan there making a poor error in the field. Yeah, so I think a lot is down to the individual. I don't think it's a general... You can't generalise, the recovery for any particular person. I think if you are fit and you are thorough with your recovery routines, rehydrate correctly, eat correctly, sleep correctly, wake up the next day and prepare correctly for the challenge that lies ahead, I think it's not that hard. They'll feel it, but it's not impossible. Nicely tucked around the corner from Shakib. Really has got some lovely touch against spin, and there's a great example.
Understanding the field as well, there was no one at that short fine leg position. There will be now after this shot. One of the things that has come into the game, which sort of leads to my next question to you. At 65 before Shakib came to the crease, finally short fine leg in position now. So often we hear the modern T20 player plays with no fear. No fear of being dismissed. Is that really the case? Do batsmen not feel pressure to maintain their position in the team?
Of course they do. It's a natural human instinct to fear failure. Some put themselves in a position where they don't fear it as much as others, purely by the way they prepare and how clear their mind is. How clear their mind is under pressure, and a lot of that can be done through the thoroughness of their preparation and also the role clarity they have within the team. They know exactly what their role is. Lovely hit down the ground. It's not going to find the boundary. Smith's going to come around quickly. He's going to fumble though. They'll pick up a couple. So that's the greatest challenge for any player, is clearing that fear aspect and, number one, understanding their role, and two, playing that role with freedom. Once you play outside that role, that's when you get questioned.
Good work by Rampaul. Keeps it to one. 92 for four.
And you've got to be fit and rehydrated to be able to perform at your best. And these girls are doing very much that, Bish.
Wade Parnell back into the attack.
Oh, you're not giving me anything, are you?
Hey?
Wade Parnell back into the attack. What point does a batting unit start to think, well, this is tee off time, and does it depend on how many wickets they lose?
Yeah, I think a lot depends on how many wickets you've lost. I think a lot depends on the batsmen that are in at the moment, how bliss they are at the crease, and also what conditions you're playing on. Is it a wicket that you can just stand and deliver and hit the ball out of the ground? Well, this wicket has proven over the last 2 days that that's not an easy task. Only a couple of people have done that successfully. So I think it's putting all those things into consideration and then making the right decision.
Teams talk about teeing off from all things being equal for the last five. Some people talk about the last six overs being the key time over number 15 to start going. Wahab Riaz has certainly slowed everything down as far as impetus is concerned with three wickets in that over. He's had a tough time since that first game of the Champions Trophy in the summer. But every little thing helps to build confidence.
Yeah, look, he's a genuine wicket taker. He bowls with good pace. He's 100% effort bowler. And he can change the course of the game, which he's done here today. He's done a terrific job. He's been picked up by the Tridents as a strike bowler, and it's exactly what he's done today. He's still got one over to go, and no doubt he'll be coming back into the attack towards the back end of the innings.
Oh, good from Parnell, and Shakib was busy looking to take a single, and the ball rolled back towards, probably onto the stumps.
Yeah, good Yorker jamming it out, and the ball spun back viciously. I think it may have even hit the stump. May have just sort of nudged it. Oh yeah, there it is. Heavy bales.
And base of the stumps. But you're right, these bales aren't removed that easily.
That's because they've got zinc.
Lovely shot from Shakib Al Hasan.
Well, this is a poor ball. It's a short ball on a slow wicket, just sitting up saying, well, where would you like to hit me, please? Yes, he's got the field set back there, but really, so many better deliveries to bowl at this stage of the game with these conditions, Bish.
Agreed. Nice shot. And Dwayne Smith turning back the clock and racing across the ground at a deep extra cover. 100 comes up. 100 for four after 15.
So we got five overs to go here in Lauderhill, and it's the Tallawahs from Jamaica being held together by Andre McCarthy, 38 from 31. Shakib Al Hasan has given him good support, 16 from 15. After that little burst from Wahab Riaz, three wickets and four balls. Shoaib Malik now, two overs, none for 14, on for his third over. Lofted for six, a hero maximum over mid-wicket.
To access that area, even though he tried to do it, that delivery.
Andre McCarthy, 45 from 34. That's a healthy strike rate of 132. And he's got two fours, and you've just seen the second of his two sixes. Now, Shakib. Easily home. Nick Pooran is the keeper.
I actually think Kane Williamson should have thrown it to the strikers end. Good pick up. tried to get rid of it straight to the keeper. Sometimes the shortest end is often the best end to throw.
Gave himself some room, and the result is four.
Well, this is a quality innings, given the fact three wickets fell at the score on 65. And the fact that he was able to create the width by moving so far out to the leg side, almost the wide line, created the right angle.
Well bowled. 112 for four. Six bowlers at the Tridents. Wahab Riaz, two overs, eight dot balls, three for seven. Settle for those. Three for seven in two overs from Wahab Riaz.
Great thing is he's still got another two overs to go.
Shoaib Malik's bowled three. He's gone for 26. Imran Khan, two overs, none for 10. Looks like it's going to be Wahab Riaz.
We haven't seen a no ball yet. Someone quickly touch a piece of wood.
Are you suggesting that possibly Wahab might be too keen and might just get that front foot over the line just to
shade? Well, based on what I've heard Ian Bishop say, that he's seen him a number of times bowl these no balls, so costly for his team. Fingers crossed he can stay behind the line.
So 2.1 overs, nine dot balls in 13, three for seven. Average speed 135, so he's always gunning for good speed, Wahab Riaz. He does bowl slow balls, but he doesn't believe, I think he'd rather bowl a quicker ball, but he's learned the craft of bowling slow balls, and he does have a good variety of them. Two is the call, and they will get to. Ravi Rampaul, the fielder, not a very good throw either.
See, I think the important thing for fast bowlers is that, yes, they need to be bowling as fast as they can, but to be able to go up in speed. So his fastest delivery is 137, his slowest is 106. So by having that little extra oomph, it really does surprise the batsman.
Slapped. Ooh, just short of the man out in the deep. And that is the 50 partnership between McCarthy and Shakib Al Hasan, and it's come from just 36 balls.
Well, that's probably been the most exciting partnership we've seen so far here, Lauder Hill. Most of the batters have struggled to get their timing right.
That's a good partnership. Taking photographs. They're Gautam Bimani's friends. McCarthy on strike. Leg side, that'll be a reload for Wahab Riaz.
Still pretty good figures. He wants to make sure that he finishes this over well. Just the four runs coming from it, wide last delivery. Important thing is that he doesn't overcorrect because of that wide down the leg side. Still needs to be able to bowl that tight line. No width on offer. No.
Oh. And that single gives Andre McCarthy his 50. That's the first 50 he has scored in any T20 match, his debut, if you like, in 2020 cricket, and an El Dorado celebration.
It was a little bit...
Well, a little bit muted, but he knows the value. Well, there was a naught in it, but there's a five in front of it as well. Oh dear, Wahab, where's... Wahab has lost his radar.
Well, Nicholas Pooran did really well, because if he didn't get a glove on that, it would have been five wides. So the keepers today have been outstanding. The amount of runs that they've saved affected run outs as well in the game before.
Well, this over looks a little bit like a dialing code at the moment. 0-2-1, 0-1-1. Needs a four or a six. Two's the call. Should be a second run here. Pollard. Good innings this from Andre McCarthy. His first 50 in 2020 cricket. Two sixes and three fours. Hits the ball crisply. That was a great six off Shoaib Malik. Better from Wahab. Eventually this over finishes. 122 for four, three overs left.
Well, McCarthy, 29 years of age. You'd expect him to have scored T20 50 prior to this, but sometimes, especially in the shortened format, you don't often get the opportunity. Batting up the order now, coming in at number three, and it's allowed him to have the time out in the middle, and he's struck the ball really well. 135 is his strike rate.
Well, that 50 from McCarthy, despite the efforts of Wahab, Riaz 3 for 17, Ravi Rampaul got Sangakkara, but that 50 has come off 36 balls. Now, we do have the E-Zone fastest 50 of the season. There's a $3,000 prize on offer for the player who does hit the fastest 50 of the Hero CPL. So far, Brendan McCullum with a 24-ball 50 and Colin Munro 26 balls in the first game on Thursday. Oh, dear. Well, Wahab Riaz sprayed it in that last over, and now Ravi Rampaul, it's infectious.
Well, I can understand what he was doing, because McCarthy moved away to the leg side and he wanted to follow him. So that's something to note for all other teams, that if you move around the crease, Ravi Rampaul follows you. He needs to have another option up his sleeve.
Lofted, how much on it? Oh, parried for six to hero maximum. And Pollard probably doesn't feel like a hero right now. He normally takes some breathtaking catches.
Yeah, he normally does. This time, you almost feel that he had too much time to think about, well, where are the ropes? He actually had a little bit more room to go. And then, so right at the last minute, he lunged at the ball, which meant that he had hard hands, and the ball, just to rub a little bit of salt into the wound, went for six.
Oh, brilliant riposte that is from Ravi Rampaul. Well, he's had a life, hasn't he, McCarthy? Normally, that would stay in those big hands, but not this time. Dropped on 22. Hard, a difficult chance from Kane Williamson. Enjoy watching Kieron Pollard in the field. He's brought up some great catches.
This time in the air. No. Chris Barnwell, the fielder this time. That was tantalizingly close. The bowler always feels that when he sees the ball going away from him, the fielder sees the ball coming to him, and the bowler probably felt this should have been taken. Ooh. Well,
if he had kept going, he would have found that he could have gone for the full dive, and maybe he would have picked it up. I guess Rampaul's disappointed with the fact that he should have had his second wicket in that over, given the fact that Pollard normally eats them up for dinner regularly. But he parried that over the boundary for a six. So now he's searching for his second wicket. He's trying to bring back this over. Wide first delivery, six, a dot ball, and now one. And there's still three balls left. So this is a big over for the Jamaican Tallawahs.
Shakib on strike. Bit of width this time. He's hit that well. Handy bit of footwork. Once again from Chris Barnwell. Nice little touch that. You don't often see the feet being used these days out on the boundary.
You're not anymore. You used to see it regularly.
Oh, I had the best left foot in the world. Look at that. There we are. Look, there we are.
My fear is that you brought... You put your foot on the ball, you roll.
Trouble.
And
ankle.
Then ankle, the ball goes for four. Your worst nightmare. Use your hands.
Wide. There is a run now, but I think if Shakib had not have contacted that, that would have been another wide.
Well, again, fielding seems to be costing the Tridents. Lapses in concentration.
Sorry, Lise, we've had eight wides. Eight wides in this innings.
Well, and that also would affect extra balls, extra opportunity to score. There you go again. He follows him. Good over for the Tallawahs, 133-4.
I think he's going to have to look for some new fans, some new flags, I reckon. Two overs to go here. Two overs and 133-4. Here's Wahab. Shakib Al Hasan. Six. Hero maximum six. Great blow struck by Shakib.
A really important blow. Not only because it's brought about six, but he's done so in the first ball of the over. All left-handers are strong in this area. They clear the front leg. They always eye off that cow region on the leg side. Strong shot.
Yeah, I think he's picked his area well. It's gone again. Flatter this time. It's four. Well struck blow by Shakib. It takes the score to 143.
10 runs off the first two deliveries. Wahab Riaz is trying to bowl into the wicket to get that variable bounce. And to stop that, Shakib Al Hasan is going at the ball hard. And everybody likes it. So his option now, I think he has to change. Either he has to go up towards the helmet or Yorker length.
Did you see Keswick Williams moving there? Oh, cheeky, cheeky Shakib. Oh, beautifully done. Oh, I like that.
We talk about cricket being a mind game and you're playing almost chess against the opposition. Two balls, short of a length, he swats him over mid-wicket, knows he's going to go full, so comes inside and just helps it along the way.
Yeah, man, go, go.
He's definitely a candidate for the hero fan of the match.
Now, Shakib, his strike rate now with four fours and a six is 154. This is an expensive over from Wahab Riaz. Tries to get the Yorker in. Six, first of all. First ball of the over, then four, flat. Really hit well. And then that little improvised shot there. And then Keswick Williams enjoyed that. It's a snooker maximum right now. 147. Well bowled. Good full length from Wahab Riaz. So he's 6-4-4, two dot balls.
Well, we've been talking all yesterday and today about 150 being the par score. It certainly looks like Jamaica Tallawahs are going to get there. Given the fact that they were 65-4, this partnership, 82 off 53 deliveries, has given them that, just that impetus they need in the back end.
Oh, brilliant. A terrific response and riposte that is from Wahab. 148-4.
We finally got his right length. Last two deliveries right at the batsman's toes. That's what he was trying to do in the third ball of the over. Sometimes as a bowler, you've just got to take out of your mind what the batter's going to do and just nail the right line and length, regardless of what they do.
One over to go. It's going to be Wayne Parnell. Now, this... Wayne Parnell, yesterday, his first over went for 15, and it was with some surprise that he bowled another over. But he's going to be bowling here now to a partnership that's worth 83 from 54. McCarthy's batted splendidly for his 60. And Shakib Al Hasan, 38. In full flight, Shakib is just wonderful to watch. Okay, it's 148 for four, six deliveries to come. Here's Parnell. Is that wide? Ooh, he's got away with that.
I think that's a good delivery in the sense that you would expect Shakib Al Hasan to kind of open up his front leg and try and get the ball over that straight or to that mid-wicket region again. So by sticking to that wide line means it just takes it out of his hitting zone. So a slight change in the field now. Third comes up inside the inner circle and cover goes out onto the boundary.
Bowled. Very well bowled. Squeezed out the Yorker.
Well, it's a bit of a concern given that third just came up. So this is the double bluff, isn't it, that we're starting to see with bowlers. Sometimes they go, well, if you're good enough to get it down there.
It was a risk. Wayne Parnell comes from the Eastern Cape of South Africa. It's a bit windy down there. We've had a breeze blowing all day here today. It's been a welcome breeze. Now round the wicket to McCarthy. Oh, he's lofted this. It's gone miles high. It should be a simple catch. Easily done. Imran Khan takes the catch. No celebration there. You've got to take those. They're regulation. McCarthy has gone for a very well compiled, attractive 60 from 44. It's 149 for five.
So Will Bolt, Wayne Parnell is taking the pace off the ball. Bolt into the wicket. McCarthy trying to go straight. Certainly got a lot of height. Distance was lacking. So good catch, Imran Khan.
Jonathan Fu is the new bat, but Shakib tries to get this away. He can't. This is a pretty decent over so far from Parnell.
Well, this is why Jonathan Fu has come out to the middle, and he may not even face a delivery. But well bowled, Wayne Parnell. Change of pace, working a tree.
He's caught hold of this, and he will get four. He stretched for that, and it takes the score over the 150. It's 153 for five.
Well, change in field. A couple of balls before, cover was out, third was up inside the inner circle. They changed it. Parnell still hung the ball out, outside off. And in the end, all Shakib Hasan needed to do was get something on it.
Final ball of the innings. Clipped away for one, and they won't go back for the second. So at the end of the 20 overs, the Jamaica Tallawahs put on a commanding total of 154 for five. Shakib Hasan finishes 44 not out, and Andre McCarthy contributing 60.
Yeah, a little bit disappointed the fact that Shakib Hasan didn't come back for two, because the throw actually wasn't even close to the stumps. And you see so many times the last ball at the end of the innings, they hustle and try and grab as many runs as possible, because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter if you're not out or out. But anyway, a great performance by Jamaica Tallawahs, 154 for five. First time we've seen so far here these games at Lauderhill score over 150. McCarthy really was the star today, 60 off 44 deliveries. Wahab Riaz picked up three wickets in one over when the score was on 65. Lendl Simmons again performed well at the top, wasn't able to kick on like he did yesterday. And Shakib Hasan struck the ball really well at a 137 strike rate.
3 for 32 in the end for Wahab Riaz. 1 for Rampaul, 1 for 37. Parnell, 1 for 26. Good last over from him. It only went for 6. Hosein was 3 overs, none for 23. Malik, 3 overs, none for 26. And 2 overs from Imran Khan cost him 10. So for the first time here at Lauderhill, we've had a team that's gone past 150. 154 for 5. And the target will be 155. And the required run rate will start at 7.75. Let's go downstairs with Ian Bishop.
Wahab Riaz, 3 for 32. How happy are you with those figures?
Quite happy that got some wickets behind my belt, but probably not happy with the last over I bowled, especially the first three balls.
Any regrets about the third delivery of that over, the first to Rovman, Powell not being a bit straight on the hat-trick ball?
Yeah, obviously I was trying to go, like I wanted to go across him, wanted him to come and play me on the front foot, but he left it well. And secondly, the same ball he tried to play, and it was an inside edge ball, so that was good.
The drummers are walking past here, so I'm not sure whether you can still hear me. When you're running into bowl at someone you know very well, you know Imad Wasim's game very well, do you have a perceived idea of his weakness as a batsman?
Yes, I know that he's a bit lazy. As soon as he comes into the crease, he's not that much active. So that was the time that I know that he will stand and he will try to flick me on the onside. Okay. And if I get it right, so I will get him. So that's what it happened, basically.
Is this a total you can chase?
Yes, definitely. I think the wicket is quite better than before and the ball is coming on to the bat really well. Yesterday, the ball was sticking in. The slow balls, which you put into the wicket, they were just sticking a bit. But now it's coming on to the bat nicely. It's just that we have to build our innings really well and if we can get to the target.
Congrats on your performance today and all the best for the rest of the match.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
So 155 to win for the Barbados Tridents to beat the Jamaica Tallawahs. The run rate starts at 7.75.
How we play.
Kane Williamson. This is what we saw from Andre McCarthy with 60. Lendl Simmons 30. Shakib Al Hasan. Hasan, 44 not out at the end. He steered them home to getting that total of 150. For five. And the bowling figures with Wahab, Riaz got a bit expensive towards the end. He did have one stage, 3 for 7, 3 for 30. Be pretty destructive at the top of the order as well. Now, Dwayne Smith is the ideal man to go out there and start plundering runs. So what are we going to see from this opening partnership right here? Drums are going, the hips are swaying. Yo. The cymbals. Come on, put something into it. We've got some great drummers here. These guys have been on the button. Right, Dwayne Smith. 34 years of age now, Dwayne Smith. He's been a destroyer of attacks in the CPL, over 1,000 runs. strike rate well in excess of 100. And Kane Williamson, the New Zealand black cap skipper, early days in his CPL career. But you know a lot about him, Tom
Moody. I certainly do. Yeah, he's a very fine player. And I think both these openers complement each other, play very differently. And they're going to have to deal with Krishmar Santoki, who's got a very good record as well in T20 cricket. He's very effective. And with a new ball, he can swing it into the right-hander. But not a great deal of pace, but he's got a good slower ball as well, so he's got good variations. Now, he'll certainly need to be on song here because Smith looked in good form yesterday.
Right, 155 is the target for the Barbados Tridents. Swing, great ball to start.
Yeah, that was terrific, wasn't it? He's got it right up there, knowing that he's got a little narrow window where the ball will swing. And this is just arced in nicely. Could quite easily just hit him on the end of the toe there, couldn't it? And then he would have been in big strife.
So in his mind, Smith knows that the ball is swinging from Santoki. Another one. Just keeps the batsman honest when he knows that the ball's swinging late like this. Then Dwayne Smith can't take liberties for a full drive. Watch how the bat just comes down on the swinging ball. Terrific contest. This swinging ball against a naturally aggressive batsman. Dwayne Smith looking for a sponsor. Three very good deliveries to start off a spell. He's given Smith nothing.
Yeah, interesting field placement too for Santoki. He's got the third man up for Smith and opted to have the deep mid on back. Interesting to see if he'll hold the same field for Kane Williamson. Doesn't look like that third man is going to move. So it is going to be the same field, which I find quite interesting because Kane Williamson's more likely going to thread you through point and backward point looking for a boundary. He's renowned for playing the ball very late. It's not really his game early on to be launching it down the ground. So I would have thought that mid-on would be better employed up in the ring and possibly having the third man back just to cover that space. And if you don't want the third man back, maybe have the cover back. As Kane Williamson is a lovely driver of the ball through the offside, so he's just sort of filling a gap or protection on the boundary in an area where his strength is.
This one doesn't swing, but it leaves the bat. That one went away towards slip and Kane Williamson latches onto it.
And that's where that cover could have been instead of that deep mid on. It wasn't a great delivery, but Williamson is such a good driver of the ball, getting across his crease, getting low to make sure he gets perfect timing and also placement.
Just straightens up this one. Oh, it's a misfield now. They'll go. Can you hear Kumar Sangakkara saying, two hands, two hands. 7-0 wicket. Got a bit of a problem with the side screen. Kane Williamson, the fan club is in town. Jimmy Johnson, the NASCAR champion, the world's best, 7 times champion. Imad, Wasim, left arm spin. Oh, we got a problem. Houston,
The sight screen is blown all over the place and the Dorado bottle looks like it's leaving.
Carl,
perhaps it's empty. The El Dorado. Danny Morrison must be in town. It's quite a we've had a strong blustery wind most of the day and it's really picked up now. Yeah, it's not the implement you want on a day like today.
Yeah,
155 is the target. It'll be the highest run chased here in 2 days if it is going to be achieved. Important runs at the end from Shakib Al Hasan. Half a shout from Sangakkara. Ball was going down.
Yeah, beautifully bowled by Imad Wasim. He bowled well yesterday. Took 2 for 16 yesterday. And, he does take the responsibility of bowling a number of overs in the power play. And he can be difficult, particularly to the right-hand batsman. He just creates very good angle in towards the right-hander and restricts them from scoring with his subtle change of pace and gets the odd one just to straighten off that line. He's a clever bowler.
Oh, he's done him. He's gone right through Kane Williamson. And another fine piece of bowling takes that off stump. Imad Wasim has struck. And that's a welcome sight for the Tallawahs to see the back of Kane Williamson. Williamson's gone for 7. It's 10 for 1.
Hey, beautifully bowled. Just a little bit quicker. Pushed through, flatter, and just skidded through. And Williamson playing down the wrong line. That's a big scalp. As Williamson would have been setting himself to bat through the innings and have the power players bat around him, so an early and important strike for the Tallawahs.
New batsman is Shoaib Malik. So Malik has been playing cricket a long time in the Caribbean Premier League, has an average of 40, strike rate a healthy 121, 21 scores of 30 plus. Well, I like to see these guys going home. I have to put him in the back of a truck, I think.
Yeah, just pushed through. You can see the flight of that delivery. It was flatter, a little bit quicker, and just pushed through. Just skipped off the wicket, did Williamson for the line, because it just straightened ever so slightly, but also the pace of the delivery.
Smith. Very muscular player, Dwayne Smith. He really loves to go downtown, loves to go down the ground. He's got big, strong arms. You'll have a different approach. You'll see a different kind of batting from Shoaib Malik.
Well, again, Malik's similar to Kane Williamson. He's an accumulator. You know, he'll just knock it round and feed the strike to Dwayne Smith, particularly during these power play overs where Smith can take advantage of the field restrictions. He only allowed 2 on the out in the outfield during those 6 overs.
Can't do much about that delivery.
A round arm action, but can get it right up into that block hole, and early on he'll get it just to shape back in to the right-handers.
down the ground for one. Well, all the way through this Hero Caribbean Premier League, we'll be playing the Dream 11. It's the fantasy scorecard. Andre McCarthy leads in this match, 40.5 points. Wahab Riaz with three wickets with 36 points. And Shakib, 27.5. Just go to dream11.com. Have a look at that. There's prizes to be won. Wide. Well, that's the kind of delivery that was stroked for four by Kane Williamson.
There's just no pace on it, wasn't it? There was an off-pace delivery. He, you know, ran his fingers over it, threw it out wide, and was probably hoping that Malik may have got into the shot too early and hit the ball aerial into the covers to bring him a wicket.
Straight again, just a single. Four from the over, three gone. It's 14 for one.
To the two coaches for the Tallawahs.
What do they write down there, Moods? Are you?
I think they're doing a crossword.
Let's have a look. What's that? Oh, secret, was it?
A little message there from Paul Nixon, who's the head coach of the Tallawahs. Took them to the finals and a successful campaign last year.
Yeah, he was there last over as well. No, he was there last
over. See that quite often in T20 cricket. Yeah. The coaches just get a message out there. Maybe a bowling change, it may be a subtle change in the field. It also might be a personnel change in the field. Maybe they got the wrong person in the wrong place in the field. Come on. Just those little attentions to detail that can make the difference between one or two runs, which ultimately counts at the end of the day. Alan?
Certainly does. Thomas? Bowled. Imad Wasim has become a very, very good bowler. He knows he's got great control. Big scalp for him to get Kane Williamson.
Well, it's interesting because the left-arm spinners are at home against the right-hand batsman in the power play overs. And likewise, the off-spinner, the right-arm off-spinner, is at home to the left-hand batsman. A little fumble will enable him to get through for an easy single. And a lot of it's to do with the angle that's created, and there's a really good example. Good angle coming wide of the crease to Kane Williamson, just skidding through off the wicket and taking his off peg. Oh, shot. Wonderful shot. Some easy footwork down the wicket from Malik and just lifts it over mid-off's head.
Classical shot this from Shoaib Malik. The grace which he plays this shot. It's beautiful to watch.
Come on.
Yeah, the key to that shot was that he didn't try to overhit it, did he? He just got himself into a really nice position to control it over that mid-off field. He recognised that he was inside the ring, obviously, and he just had to get enough bat on it to clear him.
End of the over, 22 for one.
22 for one. The Barbados Tridents are chasing 155 to beat the Jamaica Tallawahs. And we're going to see Mohamed Sami coming on to bowl now. Kane Williamson is gone. Bowled by Imad Wasim for the Tallawahs. 60 from Andre McCarthy. 44 not out from Shakib Al Hasan and Lendl Simmons with 30. Change of bat for Dwayne Smith. Well, he hasn't done much. He's in the sense that he's got 7 singles from 11 balls. Smith is on strike now. He would prefer the extra pace of Mohamed Sami bowling at him rather than Imad Wasim with his left arm spin.
Hey, you would have thought so. Certainly easier for the top order to deal with the ball with pace on it. He can then sort of pierce the field. He's strong off the bat and backhand front foot, so he'll welcome a short ball if it comes. If he overpitches, he loves to drive down the ground. Mohamed Sami will be looking for a better day today. He was a little bit off yesterday. It was expensive.
There's a lot of Simmons there. Good fielder. Fields in that inner ring area. Malik was a bit late taking off there. There's a big appeal here. The umpire's gone upstairs. Malik was slow out of the blocks. Gary Mathurin with the throw here. And I don't think Malik has made it. Has he? Doesn't look good for him now. No, he's not in the frame there. So Shoaib Malik was a bit slow going for that single, and he's gone. Fine piece of fielding by Gary Mathurin. Malik's gone for 8. It's 23 for 2.
They're quite brilliant from Mathurin in at backward point. Generally have your best fielder there, and he certainly proved his worth here. Just got onto it so quickly. Just looking to tuck it with soft hands there behind point. Mathurin would have scooped in on that left side and thrown it in. Look at that. Whack. Pick up. Quick throw. Good night. Good fielding.
Akeal Hosein comes in now. Just have a look. Couple of things to look at here. Stops and starts again, but now Malik is going the long way around here. He should have come in more towards the stumps, would have been a shorter route, but he's actually gone in an angle, a diagonal, just added perhaps an extra yard.
And if he went on that straight line that you're referring to, probably the ball would hit him in the middle of the back.
Yeah.
Instead of the stumps. He'll have a bruise, but he'd be still out there.
Yes. Should be 2, no. So the new batsman is Akeal Hosein. Well, he's been promoted up the order.
Yeah, it really does surprise me. I'd love to know the logic behind it. We can talk about that, but let's just have another look at this throw. Terrific bit of fielding. Anticipated it early. Came in, clean pickup, and an accurate throw. Yeah, Akeal Hosein batted well yesterday, 22 off 10. But to be promoted in front of Pooran, Pollard, Barnwell, and then Parnell is a massive jump. So has he been given the license, right, I want you to go out there and just go for it, ball one. And let's take advantage of the remaining eight deliveries in this power play. Or do they just feel he's hitting the ball well? He deserves the chance.
Yeah. Well, he's off the mark, first ball.
But it's interesting, isn't it, to what the logic is, and that there would be a clear plan, a clear logic, and in that camp with the Tridents is a lot of experience. A lot of calm heads, a lot of people that have been around a long time. Robin Singh has been around T20 for a long time. He's been part of this franchise for a long, long time. Pollard has played as much T20 cricket as anyone. So there's a very good thinking camp there. So it must have a lot of confidence in what Hosein can deliver.
Very well bowled. Three from the over. It's 25 for two from five.
For two after five overs. The interesting point is the original run rate was 7.75, and now the required run rate has gone up above 8.5. It's 8.67. So that's something that both Smith and Hosein need to keep a lookout, because they certainly don't want it to go past that 9 and up to 10 with a lot of overs still left in the bank. Johan Kloeter, umpire from South Africa. Williams,
you baller, right, I'm over.
Come into the attack for the first time. Going to push for two, and they're going to get it easily. And I like the fact that Dwayne Smith, even as he touched in for the second, he was actually looking for the overthrows, making sure he didn't run past the stumps too much. Jonathan Fu out there in the deep. Listening to Tom Moody and Alan Wilkins talk about the reasons why Hosein has come up the batting order. And they mentioned that potentially within the camp they felt that he's been striking the ball really well. That he should be given more opportunities. As that's brought in just inside the boundary. I don't know, Ian, is it worth early on in this stage changing the batting order?
Yeah, I'm not sure that it's something, it's a plan that I would have come up with. He's a decent player, developing player as a batsman. He has one first class 100, Akeal Hosein. Did strike the ball nicely yesterday. He'll come back to it. We saw Nicholas Pooran come. Where did he come yesterday? I think, yeah, he came in at 4 yesterday. Now, is Akeal Hosein one who rotates the strike better? Do they want to maintain a left-hand, right-hand combination with someone who can just rotate the strike rather than someone who has a dip at it
as this guy does, Nicholas Pooran, whether they have another specific role for him towards deeper in the innings, chasing this 150. I don't know. We can only speculate. We'll ask Pollard a little bit later, whoever is doing the presentation and talking to the captains.
Yeah, it is interesting to note, I know having played a bit of the T20 cricket in, from the franchise point of view, coaching staff always want flexibility in their order. It's almost like the opener is a stock standard, but 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 can change depending on whatever the situation is. Helped away nicely. A very typical Dwayne Smith shot to end the over. 34 for 2.
It is a shot that Dwayne Smith has played very well over his career. A little short-arm jab growing up in Barbados on the harder, truer pitches. Keswick Williams berated himself after the shot was played.
Two quick wickets to have fallen at 10 and 23 since then. This partnership still early on, 11 off just the 9 deliveries. Still plenty of batters to come for the Barbados Tridents. Pooran, Pollard, Barnwell, even Wayne Parnell certainly is very handy with the stick. Oh. Power play has finished. And the Jamaica Tallawahs at the same stage were 45 for 1. So the Tridents are down in runs and also an extra wicket.
Looked as though it kept a little bit low that last delivery. Few shots played in the power play. There was the early wicket of Kane Williamson falling to Imad Wasim. Shoaib Malik played a decent shot or two before he was run out by excellent fielding from Gary Mathurin. And then the last ball to finish the power play.
Again, good running, good single. Soft hands and a good understanding of exactly what each other are trying to do as well. That's something, you know, we as commentators we've spoken in the box a lot about singles, making sure you still utilize the decent deliveries and get up the other end. It's really soft hands and an early call as well is the key. By Sangakkara, 39 years of age, keeping behind the stumps. Credit to him. I can see your thinking there, Mr. Bishop. Your mind works in mysterious ways. Please share.
I'm glad it works at all in the minds of some people. I was just thinking, trying to work out the Akeal Hosein move. I think there's also a premise, a trend of thought that you want your best players to face as many deliveries as possible in this format, unless they've got a defined role at the end of the innings. So when you've got Nicholas Pooran, who really is a much better player than Akeal Hosein, and I only use Hussein's first class 100 to emphasize the point, he is a capable player, he can bat. I know it's a different format. You've got Kieron Pollard himself, who has his defined role.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, Nicholas Pooran last CPL scored 217 runs at 27, the strike rate. Now, this is impressive, 197. So maybe they think, because they're chasing 154, they want that power hitter in the middle so that if they the run rate gets up to 8, 9, 10 with plenty of overs, they've got big strikers. Just the one there. But based on that theory, and I agree with you, coaching staff regularly want to have their best batters facing the majority of deliveries. Well, then Nicholas Pooran should be coming in. My concern is that Akeal Hosein is only 23 years of age. So still young, still trying to figure out what his role is. So sometimes you don't want to change them too much. Oh, hesitation. Still, if he had hit, I reckon that would have been really close. Four runs from it, 38 for two. That would have been closest last single taken. Should I say nearly taken? Well, a big day here in Lauderhill, a double header. We had two games yesterday as well. The dancers have been going non-stop to entertain the crowd that's come and watch this hero CPL. So the morning match was a replica of yesterday's match, Patriots 132 for three. Again, we're able to overcome the Guyana Amazon Warriors. They won by four runs. Gale 66 not out. Added the whole innings. Because of that, they've started off really well. St. Kitts Nevis Patriots, 4 points. Given the fact that last two CPL competitions last in both occasions. So great start by them. Change in leadership, change in players coming over has certainly helped them. Great opportunity for the game to be here in the US. I saw a little bit earlier the policeman explaining the rules. How they'd explain it, all the pitchers coming in. It's great to expose the game. Shakib Hasan into the attack.
Boss. Short mid.
So we've seen spin play such an important role throughout the last 2 days simply because the wicket has been a lot slower. And if the spinners get it right, not only can they extract bit of spin, they can make it very difficult because there's hardly any pace on the ball for the batters to use. Just getting the angles right, Kumar Sangakkara.
That ball.
It's a nice move to get Shakib on for me, particularly with, well, not necessarily with Hosein, but certainly for Dwayne Smith. Smith needs to get some more impetus into his innings. He's got a strike rate of 65 right now. He also has a weakness against left-arm spin. In fact, he was LBW yesterday to Shakib Al Hasan, Dwayne Smith.
My concern with him, Dwayne Smith, against Shakib Hasan is there's no foot movement. And this is yesterday, his dismissal, trying to sweep. He's not a big sweeper.
Hey!
Uppish. Evades the cover fielder. But yeah, very limited foot movement, and he just plays from the crease.
Yeah, and I make that assessment just from purely anecdotal evidence, but it's like Brendan McCollum. Whenever you see Brendan McCollum, don't know what the stats show, but the left-arm spinner generally comes on from quite a few teams. Smith, I think, same thing.
It seems to be hard for players, and we've seen a lot of the left-arm spinners, they're not big turners of the ball. Maybe because they come in as a spinner and there's the element of it's going to turn, but it just keeps coming in straight, and so you're always second-guessing yourself. Is this one turning? Is this one not? That's why left-arm spinners have been so effective. Well, this guy is chilling back and just watching the cricket. A Guardian group live easy moment. These guys, I haven't had to do too much work today, and rightly so. I should be here watching a bit of cricket, making sure everyone's safe and sound. Well, it's all about learning the game, and it takes all sorts.
The three of them have something on top of the stump. What they need to do is the guy pitches it. When he pitches it, has to bounce in front of the player, then he has to hit it. His goal, if he can hit it out of the ring, he gets 6 points. When he gets 6 points, they go like this. That's six. Then when he hits it, the two players, they got to cross. They run cross back and forth. They do more once, they get points. Now, if the guy misses the pitch and the ball hits the stump behind, knocks the things off, they get points that way. So the bottom line is, it's like baseball, it's like the World Series for them. Gotcha.
It's a great way. Points, the pitcher, yep. He knows we're showing it again. Short. Scott Smith, and they're not going to take the single. It's got him just under the ribs. That's going to tickle.
A similar type of length that in Keswick Williams's previous over, the last of the power play, the last ball he bowled to Smith, and Smith just short arm jabbed it away for four. And Williams admonished himself, one, because it was the last ball of the power play and he bowled an erroneous length and line.
Well, fine leg has now come up, deep backwards square. Just for that shot. Over the head. He'd come off the boundary about 10 metres. And Santoki, unfortunately, got in the wrong position. And the chance goes down.
And it's a similar shot. He got hit in the ribs the ball before. And now he plays this. Now, why was Santoki that far in off the boundary at this side of the ground? Because that's hitting with the wind. If anything, because the wind is carrying the ball, you want to be right back on the boundary waiting for it. If you're hitting into the wind and the wind is holding the ball up, then you come off the boundary just a little bit. There's the direction of the wind, that flag, that big USA flag behind our commentary position, telling you it's coming left to right.
Slower delivery, slog this time, a bit of effort in the deep, and he's able to bring it in just for a single. So Santoki has moved to short fine leg because of that. Smith slipping at the non-striker's end, and they certainly were looking for two. Needs new colourful spikes. Maybe just a little bit longer. Good delivery. Pace bounce.
He is quicker than you think. And just going back to that that pull shot for four. Now, we never know because you couldn't really tell, just look at the last delivery again, whether Santoki, who had changed position, you alluded to it, had actually gotten in his position in time, whether he had not reached his appointed position in time and he was off the boundary. That's why he was this far in. Can't really tell.
Seven runs from it, 48 for two. Tallawahs can get it under that nine-run mark.
Oh, come on.
You'll see it go up. Oh, chance at the non-strikers end. He'll certainly go up and have a look. Shakib Hosein and Mohammed Sami believe they think it's out. And yes, well short. So really good fielding. Malik able to affect the run out. So Hosein goes for 12 and it's 48 for 3. And it will also be the carib drink break.
I'm not going to be able to do it.
Match summary so far. Jamaica Tallawahs 154 for 5. Thanks largely to McCarthy and Shakib. Hosein 44 not out. Tridents 48 for 3. Wicket just fell. That of Hosein. So plenty of work still to be done by the Tridents. Wide run rate up 9.88. Wicket.
Oh, come on!
It's a run out. Bit of ball watching there by Hosein. Which meant that he did trust his non-striker and go with the call. A really good throw by Mohammed Sami. So Pollard is the new batter for Barbados Trident.
Come on, come
here. Oh, it could be an opportunity for another. Just didn't take it cleanly in the hands. Kieron Pollard, such a strong player. He didn't really trouble the scorers yesterday. He scored the one. It was bowled by Wasim. Hit powerfully down the ground. Lendl Simmons at long off. Does the work. So again, still no Nicholas Pooran. Seem to be holding him back.
And he might have been a good option when Hosein out, just to keep a left-hand, right-hand combination going, and to be able to theoretically hit with the spin of Shakib Al-Hasan with the wind as well as a left-handed batter.
Change in the field.
Oh.
So a slight change in the field. They've got a catcher quite close to the bowler. That's Jonathan Fu. And if he is going to catch it, it's going to come at some pace. So he better get his hands up.
Come on.
Yes, we did.
Oh, 50 for 3 after 10. Well, 50's up. Been a bit of a hard slog for the Barbados Tridents. Because they've, every time they've started to get a bit of momentum, they keep losing a wicket. So 105 runs required from just 60 deliveries, with 7 wickets in hand. Well, let's go down to Gotham. He's got a few fans in the crowd.
Well, we've heard that the local Americans have learned the sport just yesterday. The policeman proved that. I found a German here who apparently claims to have learned it even earlier than that. When was the day before yesterday, Christian?
Yeah, not quite. About 12 years ago, I started. I worked for a software company as a software engineer and had a lot of Indian co-workers. And I got curious, and they told me about the game. And I learned, and I'm very passionate about it. Yeah, now I'm playing myself.
You play the game yourself, I assume, for this particular club?
Yes, for the Sarasota International Cricket Club in Sarasota, Florida. And I've been fortunate, very fortunate, to play with one of the great batsmen, Shivnarine Chanderpaul. He comes every now and then and visits the club.
Yeah, he's pretty much a local. The local college tournament is named the Chanderpaul Cup. So he does a lot, as does this tournament for cricket in America.
Yes, I'm looking very much forward to have more cricket here in America. I've been visiting this stadium as often as I can, as often as there is a game. And I'm very much looking forward to more cricket coming here.
not quite the Allianz Arena. You're a Bayern Munich fan, but do you reckon more and more crowds coming in will do good for cricket in America and, of course, in the Caribbean?
I would hope so, yes. And I would have wished a little bit more, bigger audience today, but I'm looking forward to have more cricket in this area, and this is a very nice venture here.
Final question for you. Who's your favorite cricketer in the whole wide world?
It has to be Shivnar and Chandrapal.
Okay, not quite the Chris Gayle variety, but we live with that.
So there you go. Cricket from Germany to Sarasota. Here's a shout out to Lawrence Parry of Sarasota Cricket Club. They run a great tournament down there, and Lawrence moved out of Wales, spreading the gospel of Welsh cricket, of course, to Sarasota Cricket Club.
Well, cricket is quite popular in Germany. The club that I coach back home, the Mossman Men's Grey Club, one of the players there has come across from Germany, was over there for working, and so he said cricket is quite popular.
Oh, Pollard's gone here. He's a big man to stop suddenly and turn.
Yeah, you would think that both Dwayne Smith and Kieron Pollard have spent a lot of time together out in the middle, but you wouldn't think so based on their running at the moment. There's a lot of yes, no, wait, go back. And you're right, both of them are big, solid, powerful men. Once they get going, it's very hard for them to stop.
Well, this is a chip, and I'm not sure how far it's gone. Not far enough. Rovman Powell takes the catch, a running catch. And Smith has gone for a rather testing 20 from 31 deliveries. Never really got going, Dwayne Smith. He's gone for 20. It's 51 for 4.
Well, a good delivery, banged into the wicket. Smith trying to play his traditional shot where he scores so many runs by just whipping the ball to the leg side. In a sense, he got too much of a piece on it. As Rovman Powell does a nice little El Dorado celebration.
Pooran comes in. Fine looking play. He's just 21 years of age. Nick Pooran. But this asking rate is just increasing all the time. Look at that strike rate. 165. Seven scores of 30 plus. They're going to need something special from here. Pollard's on strike. Two is the original call, or the initial call. For Smith, it was a painstaking innings from Dwayne Smith. He's trying to fashion some kind of shot on the leg side, and he finds Rovman Powell.
Well, you mentioned Nicholas Pooran, his strike rate in CPL history of 165. Last year, his strike rate was 197. So he enjoys this tournament. It's a great opportunity just to showcase his skills, not only within the CPL, but also globally.
Oh, how about that? Mohammed Sami, he's not going to have any pyrotechnics from Nick Pooran because he's done him first ball. Make some notes about that one. Well, Mohammed Sami, he's a wily fox, and that's another big blow struck. Pooran's gone for a first ball duck. It's 52 for 5.
Well, maybe we put the mocker on him, but again, the ball banged in. Such an effective delivery that we're seeing here in Lauderhill. never really got up front, kind of charging and wanting to play the ball off the front foot. It means all he's going to do is get the bottom edge and collect the stumps. 2 wickets in this over. Talk about momentum's key moments in the game. I certainly feel that this could potentially be one for the Tallawahs.
Wickets tumbling here means that Chris Barnwell comes in. He's got 90 on his back. I think that needs at least two-thirds of that. Pollard, he's only been in for 5 balls. Rather strange-looking shot that was from Nick Pooran. His first ball is facing really one of the better campaigners, one of the better bowlers in this form of cricket, Mohammad Sami. Ball terrifically for Islamabad United in the PSL, fantastically well. Well, now Pollard, Kieron, it's over to you, skipper. That asking rate is heading towards 12 and over. 103 needed. Oh, I think that's got to go. Oh, he must have nicked it. Sangakkara can't believe it. He cannot believe it.
Well, he's asking the question and the umpire isn't giving him anything.
Now, what is there a bat in the way here?
That's missing middle.
Well,
you could hear in the stumps, Mike, that's missing middle.
That is such a poor decision.
Well, he's had success. He's had success against Pollard, bowled him yesterday, and should have had him again today.
Hosein!
It's well bowled from Wasim. Bowls with such confidence these days. Imad Wasim, he fancies his chances of getting big players out with his left arm spin. Well, that looks as if it's drilling itself into leg stump halfway up. Sanger jumping for eternity.
Hair gets in the way.
Well, that's gone, I'm afraid. That's history. Barnwell. Umpire's going to give that wide now.
I think Kumar Sangakkara actually said to him, that's wide.
Well, he's a statesman of the game, you know, Lisa.
He is.
Sanger, one of the...
He can keep, he can umpire at the same time.
He's one of the greats of all time right there. What's his test average? About 58, isn't it? Sangakkara, test average. Big shoes to fill for Sri Lanka.
Come on.
Jai Wardner and Sangakkara no longer in that test side. 57.44 his average in test cricket.
Come on!
Oh, no!
Which puts him, I think, in the top 5 or 6 of all time.
It does. Ponting was certainly up there, Ricky Ponting. Graham Pollock, given that he didn't play as many matches.
Come on!
Oh, Pollard says get back. End of the over. Plenty happening out there. 54 for 5.
Well, there's the questions being asked. And he's explaining and saying these are the reasons. Kumar says, let me have a chat to him. But he let it go. There's the experienced campaigner. Happy Independence Day to all the Jamaicans out there.
Drums are going, but I'm not so sure they're going for Barbados. as the asking rate now heads towards 13 and over. Oh, his hips are going there, Lisa. There you go, yeah, there you go, look at that. Now, 101 required from 8 overs. Dream 11, fantasy scorecard, Andrew McCarthy scored 60 today. He leads it in this match. 40.5 points, Wahab Riaz 36. Go to dream11.com/points.
Well, match summary so far, 154. 100 runs difference. Only 8 overs to get that.
Well, it's going to need something massive from Pollard. I mean, Pollard is one of the great destroyers of bowlers, but this is asking a monumental task from Kieron Pollard to lead Barbados home here. The Tridents need 100 from 47 balls. It's doable if that man gets going.
Well, the other way to look at it, instead of just 12 runs and over, it's 2 runs per delivery. So you don't necessarily have to find the boundary all the time. If you pick up the twos, like they're going to now, and then you also create that boundary, you give yourself every chance of chasing it down. But it's going to take a monumental effort from both of these players. Barnwell will want to ensure that he keeps really busy. Just the one run yesterday.
Well, we've got our winner of the hero fan of the match. It's the Joker. There we are. There he is. $500.
Good on him.
He looks good, doesn't he?
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. CPL, CPL. Number one. Number
okay.
One.
CPL. Number one. He's not joking.
He can do the commentary for us.
Oh, well bowled. Great Yorker, that from Williams. Oh, a little bit of a stare. How about that, then? How about that? Williams. Brilliant Yorker, that is. And have a bit of that.
I'm just looking forward to, if he does get Pollard, that notebook will certainly be coming out. He'll be going through and chalking up another wicket to his ever-growing list.
He's got a good book going at the moment. Splendid, that. He's absolutely bludgeoned it.
But the scary thing is, he didn't really get it out of the middle of the bat, did he? Bowled the wide, tried to go to the wide line. Didn't matter. Big arms of Pollard was able to reach out and fetch it.
Talk about a big bat that Chris Gayle uses. That is also a substantial piece of willow. Oh, hello, that sounds pretty good. How about that for a monster hit? That's a big one. Pollard special, 68 for 5.
I don't know about that. But have a look at this hit. No staring this time, because Williams knew exactly what had happened, because it sounded so perfect. There we go. Kid wants the ball. No, I'll have it.
What a nasty man.
Very, very competitive. Well, the helmet goes, the cap's on. Serious business now, Pollard. Again, trying to go to the wide line. You can hear the sound. And a little bit of a jostling. Father-daughter time. Delicate. Delicate from Barnwell. Santoki does the rest.
He's done well there, hasn't he? Santoki. Imad Wasim's into his last over. He's been so difficult to get away. 1 for 15 in three overs. Oh, I just worry. Whenever I see someone going sliding like that, studs first, I think of Simon Jones, the England bowler, who went like that at the Gabba. And it was virtually the end of his career. He did recover. He was never the same. The studs get caught up in the grass and the knee went a different direction.
But they do it all the time now, yeah. Don't they? It's such an effective way of fielding the ball. You slide and then you'll be able to pop up, get into a powerful position to release the ball.
Come on.
Well bowled. Smart bowling.
You're restricting it, man. He had a deal.
Big man.
Well, 83 now off 39 deliveries.
Come on!
Sanger, that's Sanger shouting from behind the stumps.
Hey, boys.
I've never heard him so vocal.
Which Sangakkara have you been watching?
Obviously, just from a batting perspective. No, seriously.
This guy talks for the World 11. Sanger, ask Sean Pollock. That was a great, great piece of cricket. Sangakkara and Sean Pollock, one of the great moments in cricket. At the Wanderers, Johannesburg, can't remember how many years ago. Oh, it wasn't nasty, it was just... Sanger, the stump mic, was picking him up, saying, come on, Polly, no pressure here. The whole of the country's watching you. You know what you've got to do. Come on, Polly, no pressure. Come on, South Africa expects. Oh, it was wonderful. And they met up in this Champions Trophy this year, this summer. Brilliant, brilliant piece of television and cricket.
Why is it that everyone reminds the South Africans about playing for the country or World Cup? Poor South Africa, 75 for 5. Coaching staff would be happier with what the Tallawahs have done.
Think that Paul Nixon on the left there, former Leicestershire player in England. And of course he did represent England as well. But now this is the El Dorado happiest fan alive. Now, gets a chance to fly to the Caribbean Premier League finals in Trinidad with Caribbean Airlines and get a VIP experience. Compliments of El Dorado.
Respect, man. Thank
you. Lucky man. Well done. Our El Dorado happiest fan alive.
Respect to everyone.
Meanwhile, Santoki delivers something. Looked like a meat pie, that.
Getting a bit hungry, are you, Wilco?
I am, actually.
Sorry, yes, for all the vegetarians out there.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Look. I should have said an orange. Ha,
Beauty and the Beast. I like it.
I think that's Danny Morrison under that mask. That's...
Thank you.
What were you saying about Beauty and the Beast?
You take your pick.
A couple of beasts behind us. Big ones, aren't they? Who's the taller?
Tall one.
Right now, someone's got to stand tall here. It's Kieron Pollard. He's got to go some here. Oh, that's a horrible delivery for Sangakkara to collect. And that's going to be four. Four wides. It'll be five, of course.
Well, it's hard for the 39-year-old to bend his back and trying to stop this. A couple of bounces, the pitch dying. Remember, this is the fourth game that's been played on this wicket. Not a lot of bounce or carry.
Ooh, how about that? Goodness, such power.
Well, you don't need two hands, do you, if you're Kieron Pollard? You just need the bottom hand to stay on the bat, and that's exactly what he did. Up in his area. A forehand tennis shot for six.
Well, he's brought down the asking rate from 13 and a half and an over to 11.
I think the five wides might have helped as well.
Yes, that helped. Couple more lusty blows from Kieron Pollard, and the Tridents are still in this. 67 from 34. While he is there, and Sangakkara knows that Pollard, if he really finds another gear, can take this away from the Tallawahs. Oh, that's a great blow. Crushing blow into the side screen. Pollard's on fire.
Well, our cameramen need to be careful, because Pollard is just about to get going. Santoki trying to find that Yorker length and missing it. Both occasions, back-to-back sixes. And this time Sangakkara says, nah, come over the wicket.
3 sixes now for Pollard. Leg side. Oh, can't get it past that man in the inner ring. Had he not played the shot, though, he would have had another ball, because that was leg side wide. Here's the 3 sixes from Pollard. Massive hit straight. One-handed over mid-wicket. And bullet straight into the side screen. This will be great if he really does get going now. He's got 30 from 17. That's a strike rate of 176. Barnwell's on strike.
Oh, bold. Good delivery.
Still positive, eh?
And that's what the Tallawahs would like. Barnwell facing now the next couple of deliveries. They'd actually love him to get a single, which means that he'll be on strike for the next over. Barnwell, 9 off just the 11 deliveries, strike rate of 81. If he faces the next couple of deliveries, they can blow out that required run rate again.
Oh dear, that's a shocker. You see the pressure now getting to the bowler. Just a couple of big blows. Santoki's gone for 32 in 2.5. And the bowler gets nervous. You start getting nervous in your run-up. You're running it. And you've got a few different thoughts going around in your head. You think, all right, we're not going to bowl to this fella. But you don't concentrate on the primary task of delivering the ball. End of an over, which has brought 22 runs. It's 97 for 5. Who's gonna win this game?
Back here at Fort Lauderdale, 97 for 560. In fact, 58 required from the last five overs. So you're not really out of it with two strong lads at the crease in Pollard, who's been there for a while, and Barnwell, who's just trying to get going. Critical overs now to come. And particularly this one from Shakib Al Hasan. This is where I think Shakib has a great advantage, in that he generally can bowl wicket to wicket. He will turn the odd one. And this is such a crucial over, Tom.
It certainly is, but he's got all the goods, but he's got experience. So he'll be quite calm. At the top of his mark, he'll be clear with his thinking. He's been in this situation many, many times, so he won't be flustered. He won't be intimidated like so many people can be with the man on strike. Just the one down to deep mid on. He really is a force to be reckoned with, Pollard, when he gets going. There's no ground big enough in world cricket to contain him.
That's up in the air. It's up in the air. Oh, and almost brilliant from Rovman Powell. It's a really good save on the boundary line.
This could be the difference. Just moments like this you look back on and remember and think, wow, that's just saved us a number of runs. Amazing athletic skill to get up, avoid the line, catch and flick it back just in time before he hits the rope. Sensational work, really is.
He is a great friend of his countryman Andre Russell, and that looked quite Russell-like.
He's probably disappointed he didn't have a chance to hold on to it. I've caught that. Oh, it's well bowled. Eh? Wide Yorker. Round arm. Get under that if you can.
So look at Rovman Powell again. Excellent judgment. Brilliant over from Shakib, just five off of it. 102 for five.
Yeah, he's bowled well, Shakib. He's only gone for 10 runs for his three. He's got one left in the bank. So it's a bit of experience there talking. Captain Sangakkara with Shakib. Both have a lot of experience, been in this situation many, many times, trying to work out which bowlers to use. We're looking at the bowlers that are available. Sammy's got one. He'll definitely bowl one in these closing overs. Santoki is probably going to have to step up at some stage again, even though he got punished. Williams is a terrific finisher. It's just the order you put them in, Bish. That's the trick. To me, you put the bowler on now that is most likely to take a wicket, because they need to remove Pollard. If they don't remove Pollard, they'll lose the match. Simple as that. And to me, this is a very good move, because to me, Williams is a man that has strike ability. His strike rate in this format is greater than most.
Okay, what does he bowl now? Because he's got options. He bowls a good Yorker, he bowls a good cutter. hitting to leg will be hitting with the wind. You've seen a lot of guys bowl the ball into the pitch to hit it into the breeze. Yep. This is with the wind leg side.
Well, to Barnwell, who's bowling two first up, to me, he mixes it up. He bowls his Yorker, he bowls his slower ball, and if not, his bouncer. To Pollard, non-negotiable. A wide Yorker.
That is not hit well enough. It is taken by Jonathan Foo, who almost misjudged it. And there we go, a little jig from Keswick. Little pace off the ball. An El Dorado celebration from Keswick Williams, and Barnwell goes.
And that's why I feel that that was a good option for him to be bowling that slower ball to Barnwell, because he doesn't have the brute force, power, skill that Pollard has. Pollard would have put that on the bank. But when he's bowling to Pollard, he has to go into the block hole, just wide of that off stump. Certainly the right delivery for Barnwell. He may have to change his thinking to the man at the other end.
Wayne Parnell is the new batsman. Batsman would have crossed while the catch was being taken. So once again, we'll get to see the second part of your theory. But it's a decent catch by Jonathan Foo. He had to be aware as to where the boundary was behind him. And he did it quite correctly, even if he almost misjudged it, I think. Williams to Pollard.
Slow ball bouncer. To me, it's high risk. You?
Yep.
I much prefer just closing the door completely on him hitting you for six. And by doing that, the wide Yorker is going to do that. One, it's going to be wide outside off stump. If he wants to hit with the breeze, he's got to fetch it across the other side.
Hit it behind square and well stopped. Fielding coming to the fore. I think it's McCarthy down there at deep backward square.
Yeah, great stop. And it is so important at this stage of the innings that you do see, you do save those odd boundaries. We've seen it with Powell the over before. Terrific save to stop a six. And now McCarthy diving away to his right, just keeping it in the field of play.
That's hit with the wind. And that's gone for six. Length in the slot. And Pollard makes it travel.
And it's travelled economy class, because he hasn't hit it out of the middle of the bat. It's not gone first class. It's not like a real sweet hit, as you would call it. It's a mishit, but Pollard mishit sixes for fun, particularly when he's got the breeze behind him.
Yeah, that's the danger of this side of the ground. If you're bowling length, sometimes it may not work. Maybe you get lucky and it works. I just wonder with Keswick Williams, I think in a previous over he was sort of wide of off stump, not fully wide, but outside off stump to Pollard, and Pollard carted him back down the ground on a couple of occasions. So maybe from a confidence point of view, not a sharp, confidently bowling full and wide outside the off stump initially, although he came with the last resort last ball. Oh, that would have been a wide. Two is the call. They get it easily. 112 for six. That Shakib over that went for five, I thought was professionally bold, very well done, and really drove the required rate up from the last four. Now we're into the last three. Who's gonna win this game? 43 required from the last three overs of the innings. Pollard on 42 from 25. Now Shakib is bowling to the left-handed Parnell, who's yet to face a delivery. That's one of the challenges, but theoretically, hitting with the wind for Parnell against anticipated spin, although Shakib won't look to spin it that much, could be a bonus. Will he go wide outside the off stump to Parnell and make it try to hit through the offside and into the wind? Staying over the wicket. So will he just bowl straight? In the air. And just short of Jonathan Foe, who's everywhere.
Willie Boulder, particularly good over the last over, Shakib. And can he back it again?
All the fielders are in front of square on the offside. In the gap like a shot out of a gun.
Shakib has tried to bowl that right up on the crease line and he's just fractionally short. He's gone wide, but it's allowed Pollard to get his arms free. And when you do that, look out. You're in strife. For me, Bish, he's far better off bowling into his pads, full into his pads. Don't allow him to get his arms free because we can see how lethally he is. And once he can get that full bat swing, look out.
I think he probably would have learned from that, because there'll be an option to try to make Pollard hit the ball through the offside because he's not as strong there. So he's tried that, it's failed. So does he revert now to shifting the line a little bit straight and into leg stump as you suggested? Let's find out. He's hit it down the ground, and again almost, but this time it's gone for six. It's 50 for Kieron Pollard, his seventh CPL half century and his 35th in T20s.
Box office, isn't he? He really is box office, this guy. Worth every penny to come and watch. When he's at the crease, anything can happen. Doesn't matter how far out of the game you are, and when he's on the boundary, anything can happen. It's a good call, actually, the Andre Russell call. That's a very good call, because he's athletic like Russell, dynamic on that boundary.
Oh, he hasn't hit this. Foo's under it. Foo's under it, and Foo takes it. Not for the first time, he's found himself in a high traffic area. It could have gone because it was a full toss hit with the wind and Parnell goes. .124 for 7.
Full pitch delivery. A real gift, you'd have to say, but it just goes to show when you first get to the crease, it still takes a little bit of time to get your timing. Parnell batted well yesterday. He had his timing yesterday, but today he was about 8 feet short.
Wahab Riaz is a new batsman, and he is an interesting story, Jonathan Fool, because a few years ago when it was the Caribbean T20, he won a semi-final and the final for Ghana off his own bat and allowed Ghana to qualify for the Champions League. He's faded since then. Now he's hit this like a rocket again, straight, and Kieron Pollard is keeping the Tridents in this contest on his own, 130 for 7.
Number 5. This is number 5, 6. With such ease. Again, I'm not convinced he's middled it, but it's good enough. He's just controlled exactly where he wanted to hit it, and that was directly over the umpire's head. Precision.
Turning out to be a glorious day. We had a very exciting first game of this doubleheader. Now can this go down to the wire? Pollard on 59. Manfully as leader, carrying this innings. No one's been significant in their contribution. Smith 20, but 31 balls it took him. Mohammed Sami into the attack. He's bowled well so far, 2 for 8 from 3 overs. Loads of experience, age 36.
He'll be looking for the Yorker. He bowls it well. Slashed away, just edging it down to third man, but it's not a bad result if you're a Trident because Pollard's on strike.
A skinny bowler, Sammy, isn't he? He's hustled a few guys in this innings by getting on to them a little bit quicker than they think. And he does bowl, as you said, a rapid Yorker. Now, does he trust himself to nail it? Because if he doesn't nail it, Pollard can take it away. As he mixed the length up.
It's well fielded. Very well fielded. Well, I think he went for the Yorker there, but didn't quite get the length. He was slightly off, and he was lucky. I think in this situation, and you're the bowler.
So were you.
Yeah, but not in your class. I was a one star. You're a five star. I feel you've got to back yourself. You've got to back your skill. It's what you're known for doing and doing well. Now's the time to deliver it under pressure.
Top edge and should be taken. He goes length to Wahab Riaz, who he knows very well, the newer of the two batsmen, and he gets success, Sammy. It's been a great atmosphere here today, and it still remains 23 to get from 9. Riaz goes for 132 for 8, and did the batsman cross?
I think they may have, Bish, and that was a very important point you bring up. Just mishitting it. The right length to be bowling to Wahab. Not getting his timing. And Imad Wasim taking the catch. So I think we'll find that Pollard will be on strike with 3 balls remaining. Still 23 required off 9 now. So game on.
Thank you.
Imran Khan is at the crease, and he's not a power player. He's an orthodox batsman who's opened the batting in first-class cricket. Now, to your point, and I think your point is a correct one as we look at the dismissal of Wahab Riaz. Usually, yeah, the batsman did cross. Come back to that. Pollard on strike. Yeah, he's going length here. And it really comes down, Tom, and you would have encountered a few bowlers. I would think the Yorker would be the good go-to ball at this stage, but there are some bowlers who would trust themselves better in these conditions or certain conditions to bowl length or slower ball or back of a length. But as you said, Sammy has a good Yorker. It's not like he's one of those guys who doesn't have a good Yorker. He's got an excellent one. That's high. Oh, they come back for two. Oh, Sangakkara has livid with someone.
You try to tell me it doesn't mean anything to him, eh? This game, this tournament means everything to Kumar Sangakkara. The captain out there, he's not happy with his fielder out there. He did not anticipate that at all. Yes, it was a good throw, but he was slow to get to it. Tell you what.
Gary Mathurin.
You wouldn't want this to go for four or six.
Oh, this should be out. This should be out. This will be game, set, and match. Well bowled, Mohammed Sami. Two wickets in the over. And the big one of Kieron Pollard. He goes for 62, well played, 134 for 9.
Quite brilliant innings, but you'd have to say a sad end because he deserved more, Pollard, because he really did drag this game out of the fire. He really did drag it out of the fire and put life into it for us all, Bish.
Ravi Rampaul is the number 11 with 21 to get off six. He knew there was a short, fine leg, so he was trying to scoop it over that short, fine leg. He anticipated pace on the ball, but Sammy followed him very well outside the off stump. Cramped him for room, Lisa Stalaker.
Certainly did, and he knew that he needed to find a boundary then and there. I still would have liked to him just to get off strike. He would have been facing the first ball, the last over. He would have needed 20 runs. You still like to back him, wouldn't you?
Especially with Santoki bowling, who he's had the wood over Santoki in this innings and in a couple of occasions before. Now, Santoki will feel much more at home. He can take pace off the ball here against Imran Khan, who's yet to face a ball. Can bowl into the pitch or he can go Yorker. Yeah, goes into the pitch, forcing the less powerful batsman to try to muscle it.
And you watch when he puts the ball into his hand, cross seam delivery often means that he's going to bowl that slower ball. It's been so effective for him against the less powerful batsman. Ravi Rampaul facing his first delivery, so you'd expect this one to be a quicker delivery.
I'd still like to see Santoki polish his skills here if he's going to go full to Rampaul, at least take him wide of the off stump, because if he goes straight and misses his length, he allows the number 11, and Rampaul is not the worst number 11, to hit with the wind. I want to take that side out of the equation. I want to make him hit offside.
And that's why you'd think to the right-hander, you'd come around the wicket.
Wow.
So you can see he's trying to keep it and hang the ball out that wide line, which means that Ravi Rampaul has to fetch the ball from a long way from off stump and then take it to the onside. Because that is always the strength, especially lower order batsmen. They like to go leg side.
Go straight for one. How critical was Dwayne Smith didn't go quickly at all at the top of the innings. Akeal Hosein came in a lot earlier than he usually does. How critical would have that, those two moves been to lack of that word that everyone likes to use, momentum?
It makes a big difference if there's a player that's eating up deliveries and not really finding their timing. And Dwayne Smith is the type of player, he would have thought, well, the longer I'm in, I'm surely going to get the timing right. But he just never got going. And because of that, I think he scored about 20-odd off 30 deliveries.
3 sixes needed. He's not that type of player, Imran Khan. He's very orthodox in the way that he bats. He's not a power player. But we saw how much it meant to Sangakkara a little while ago. Gary Mathurin, who wasn't bowled a ball in the two games they've played, specialist left-arm spinner, bats at 10 and 11 and hasn't bowled a ball, got berated by Sanga.
He did, because he's also imparting his knowledge, his wisdom, his understanding of the game. And whilst he hasn't contributed with the bat or the ball, in T20 cricket, fielding is such a crucial job. You see a lot of teams select the best fielder in those positions. So this game is just drawing out now. The Tallawahs really haven't had an enjoyable time here in Lauderhill. This is the first time that they're going to win here at this ground. Played a number of matches here, haven't registered a win. So sometimes that can play on your mind as well as a team. Well, last ball and a wicket. Simple catch to Lendl Simmons. Ravi Rampaul goes last ball, but a good solid win by the Jamaica Tallawahs. They win by 12 runs, and the captain Kumar Sangakkara extremely happy with his players. They were tested because of one man, Kieron Pollard, who gave them a little bit of hope. And every time he's out there, when he strikes the ball so cleanly, it puts so much pressure on the captain, the bowler and the fielders. Out of these two matches, both teams split the points. 2 points to Barbados Tridents yesterday and 2 points for Jamaica Tallawahs. He'd be certainly disappointed. He thought, nearly got the team across the line. Kane Williamson just congratulating him on a